morning and welcome to the 23rd meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2024. Before we begin, can I please ask members and those joining us to please ensure that all electronic devices are switched to silent. This morning we've received apologies from Colin Beattie and Beatrice Wishart and Elena Whittam, and I welcome Christine Graham, who's attending as a substitute. Our first item of business is evidence with the Scottish Government to conclude our pre-budget scrutiny for the Scottish Budget 2025-26. And I welcome Mary Goujon, the Secretary, Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands. Now, we have around 2 hours for this discussion. Supporting the Cabinet Secretary, we've got with us this morning George Burgess, the Director of Agriculture and Rural Economy; Brendan Callaghan, the Director of Operational Delivery from Scottish Forestry; Karen Moorley, Head of Agriculture and Rural Economy and Finance; Nuala Gormley, Deputy Director of Marine Science, Evidence, Data and Digital in the Marine Directorate; and Rebecca Hackett, the Deputy Director and Portfolio Lead, Corporate Strategy in the Marine Directorate. Before we begin, can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a brief opening statement?
Thanks very much, Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to speak with the Committee this morning in advance of the Scottish Budget for 2025-26. As the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Local Government set out in the fiscal statement earlier this month, the Scottish Government faces a very challenging situation as we continue to manage our finances through the current financial year and look to set the Scottish Budget for the forthcoming financial year. In the face of this challenge, the portfolio is playing a substantive and real role in helping the Government achieve its four priorities. We remain steadfast in our support of for rural and island communities. Scotland's rural and island economy is a major source of growth for Scotland, delivering an economic contribution worth £39 billion, which is 26% of the Scottish total in GVA in 2021. But we do know that communities across our rural and island areas face unique challenges. That includes the higher cost of living, and that's why we're determined to make sure that these challenges are addressed through all of our policies. Now, I'm clear that funding allocated within my portfolio is targeted to improve opportunities in Scotland's rural, coastal and island communities and has a direct and critical role to help enable communities to thrive. Now, these measures include investing over £6.7 million in Scotland's islands to support the ongoing delivery of the National Islands Plan, support for island communities through our Islands Cost Crisis Emergency Fund, as well as continuing to support Scotland's islands to become exemplars of carbon neutral communities through our Carbon Neutral Island programme. We have a strong record of direct support to our marine sectors through the European Maritime and Fisheries Fund and, since EU exit, our Marine Fund Scotland. And we'll shortly announce up to £14 million of Marine Fund Scotland funding for 24-25, supporting projects to achieve an innovative and economically sustainable marine economy, delivering real benefits for Scotland's coastal communities and reducing carbon emissions and protecting the marine environment. And that builds on grants totalling over £40 million to more than 270 projects since 2021. And more broadly, in relation to the Marine Directorate's budget, we continue to prioritise it towards our significant statutory and regulatory functions and key commitment areas. And that includes areas such as fisheries science, which continues to be a priority and where funding has been maintained at existing levels. Now, the read-through of this scientific expertise into tangible outcomes for Scotland is clear when you look at the Marine Directorate's work on international fisheries negotiations. That sees our scientific, compliance and policy functions collaborate very effectively together to seek the best outcomes for Scotland, and which brought in over £600 million of fishing opportunities just last year. Turning to our rural economy, the agriculture sector is key to Scotland's wider economy. The Rural Affairs Budget provides essential financial stability to the rural economy through provision of our direct payments. In 24-25, over £600 million is being provided in ongoing rural support to the sector. Early payments began to reach farmers and crofters from Wednesday, the 4th of September, and in total, the initial payments are worth approximately £243 million and are being paid to over 11,500 businesses across Scotland. Through the Agricultural Reform Programme, we are continuing to support farmers and crofters to reduce emissions and deliver biodiversity improvements through greater uptake of key activities such as carbon and biodiversity audits and soil analysis. And this will be key to supporting the transformation of farming and food production in Scotland so that we can become that global leader in sustainable and regenerative agriculture and supporting the industry to achieve its targets. And nature restoration is also key to these targets. And this year, we've committed under the programme for government to plant 10,000 hectares of trees, with over 4,000 hectares of this being native broadleaf. As the committee will be aware, with no clarity on future funding levels from the UK government or to what extent it's going to remain ring-fenced, we are missing a key building block for the 25-26 budget. But together with my counterparts in the other devolved nations, we're hoping for a reset in the relationship with the UK government as we join together to press for a satisfactory multi-annual settlement to be set out in the UK spending review. And with that, I'm happy to take any questions that the committee might have.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. So I'll kick off with questions on the Marine Directorate. Can you explain the main purpose of the Marine Directorate's recent restructuring and what difference stakeholders should expect to see in the delivery of fishery policies?
As I've outlined in my opening remarks there, I've highlighted the different areas of the Marine Directorate that contribute to our fisheries and, as I said in my comments, very tangible outcomes for our fisheries industry when you look at the fishing opportunities that we've secured over the course of the past few years. Now, I believe that the Directorate has been restructured to really follow more of a portfolio approach, but I think it would probably be helpful if I passed over to Rebecca, who'd be able to talk through more of that detail.
Thank you. Yes, so the restructure was principally designed to make us more flexible and responsive to future demand. So the idea of the portfolio model is that we are able to flex and adapt across different areas of delivery and adapt in terms of future need. So it has been, we are seeking to do more in the future in terms of bringing together different areas of delivery more closely. So we're already working across, as the Cabinet Secretary indicated in her opening remarks, working across policy, science, evidence and digital. But the aim of the restructure was to enable that to happen more flexibly and in a more adaptive way. I mean, in terms of stakeholder perceptions of this, it is mainly an internal reorganisation, so I don't think it should really impact our stakeholders, how they perceive Marine Directorate delivering on its core priorities.
And can you tell us what those core priorities or the key priorities are within the Marine Directorate?
You mean the priorities we're looking to deliver from a policy perspective?
Yeah, your key priorities.
I think, well, certainly from the portfolio perspective, I think there are a number of priorities. I think first of those is obviously delivering on the Future Fisheries Management Strategy that was published a few years ago now and the commitments within that, which I think will help with our overall transformation. We're starting to see some of the policy work come through. Obviously, the committee, I appeared in front of the committee in relation to REM and the rollout there. I think that was a significant policy development. We're also working on some other critical areas, such as the future catching policy, and working through the detail of that. I think at my committee appearance a couple of weeks ago as well, we also talked about the fisheries management plans. Of course, that is a key priority too. International negotiations always remain a key priority. We've talked about the different policy areas and how they all contribute to the outcomes that we see in relation to that. Ultimately, we want to make sure we're securing the best possible opportunities for our industry in Scotland. And as I've already outlined, we've seen over £600 million worth of opportunities over the course of the past couple of years too. Now, I know that the committee will also be interested in the work in relation to inshore fisheries as well. We've obviously had some of the interim measures introduced there, but that's part of the work that we're doing in relation to our transformation and how we're dealing with inshore fisheries and the overall roadmap to inshore fisheries management improvement as well. There's also a body of work. I know that I'll be also appearing in front of the committee potentially in a few weeks' time in relation to aquaculture, and the committee's been looking at that in some detail. We set out in our programme for government some of the commitments we're looking at there. Ultimately, the key focus for that part of work is delivering on the Griggs Review and the recommendations that came out with that, and also the consenting pilot work is a key component of that work that we've been delivering over the course of this past year. So I hope that helps give, I think, just some of the key areas of priority for my portfolio anyway, and what we're looking to continue to deliver over the course of the coming year.
Thank you. You touched on inshore fisheries. We had evidence from a number of stakeholders. Elspeth MacDonald for the Scottish Fisheries Federation suggested the Directorate is spinning many, many plates, and it looks to us as if the resource that has been spread too thinly over too many things. and that we have many data gaps and poor information in relation to many of our inshore fisheries compared with that of some other fisheries. Similarly, Elaine White from the Clyde Fishermen's Association said that we feel that we have less contact with staff and that staff have more pressure on them. Going back 10 years, I would make a phone call to a member of staff to sort out an issue, but that is far more difficult now. Now, we know that previous budget documents have stated that an increase in Marine Directorate have been directed towards net zero, biodiversity, expansion of offshore renewables. So is that the reason we're hearing of concerns relating to other fishery policy areas? Do you think there's been a negative impact on the delivery of fishery policy objectives because of the focus elsewhere other than towards the fishing industry?
I think there's probably quite a few points I want to pick up in the comments that you've made there, convener. Because while I recognise some of the challenges that were outlined in the committee's evidence session where they heard from some of our stakeholders, I think we do broadly have quite a strong relationship with some of our stakeholders. And I would hope that that did come through some of the evidence that you'd heard too. I mean, there's no doubt that the Marine Directorate, as other directorates across the government, are under a huge amount of pressure. And there is no shortage of work going on in the marine space, which adds to all that. But I do think that in terms of how we engage with stakeholders, there have been a number of changes in that regard. We have tried to put some of the more we've tried to put more formal structures in place to coordinate some of that. So when you look at the work that we've done on the Fisheries Management and Conservation Group as well, putting that on, setting out a terms of reference, putting that on a more structured basis to really help get a more strategic view and an engagement with some of the policies that we're looking to implement as well. We've also undertaken work in relation to our regional inshore fisheries groups too, which of course we're going to review going forward, to make sure that we have the right mechanisms in place to engage with our stakeholders and to do that in a way that they're helping us with the formulation of policies and in the delivery of that as well. I do also think what is going to help going forward is the implementation of the science and innovation strategy as well that was published at the start of the year. Because I do think, I mean, I recognise what stakeholders had outlined to the committee in terms of data gaps and evidence gaps, but with the best will in the world, the science department in the Marine Directorate would never be able to resource all of that or to fulfil all the science needs that we have. And of course, just as I mentioned in other directorates, we have to try and prioritise that work as best we can. So the Science and Innovation Strategy, I think, sets all of that out, though, how we're looking to better collaborate with other academic institutions as well. And I think there are some quite strong relationships there across Scotland. We've also had the appointment of the Chief Scientific Advisor for Marine as well, who is going to help with the implementation part of that work that will come forward. But I don't know if Nuala would want to add more information to what I've set out there in relation to the scientific elements.
Just to say that Professor Mark Innall and myself are already taking forward work to plan how we design an implementation plan on the back of the Science and Innovation Strategy. As was the case in the development of the strategy, there will be extensive engagement with external stakeholders. An element of that is a research areas interest exercise, and also there will be mapping of capability and capacity for Scottish Science Marine in that. So it will be a much more obvious route map to what work we will be prioritising and how we're going to take it forward into the future.
But I suppose my question is, given that in relation to the overall budget, when it comes to sea fisheries, the budget has basically flatlined. There's been no increase in real terms in comparison to other parts of the Marine Directorate. And you talk about the route map. But there was a suggestion that the route map was set based on the budget rather than the route map being set on what the industry actually needs. I mean, and this committee has dealt with policies which there's been issues raised by the committee about the data backing up. So we've seen struggles with the Clyde cod box and more recently with lobster and crab fisheries. So are we ensuring that the budget matches the ambitions that Noel Gormley has just set out there? Can that be achieved when the budget for sea fisheries is flatlining?
So I just want to clarify, I mean, you mentioned the route map there, but do you mean the innovation strategy that we've
published? Yeah, the annual strategy. The annual plan set out.
Our delivery plan. I mean, it's just as I say, I mean, obviously we have to try and prioritise. I would say that I have been engaging and just met recently with Elaine White of the Clyde Fishermen's Association in relation to the work in Clyde Cod. We're really keen to, it's, you know, I set out in broadly in relation to the science and innovation strategy. It's about how we can best utilise resources that we have across the piece and collaborate with others, whether that's other academic institutions, but it's also about working with industry as well. And there are already a number of programmes underway where we work with and collaborate with industry in relation to that as well. I understand the criticism that's come in relation to the interim measures and the inshore fisheries, which I've discussed with you as well, Convener, in relation to some of the specific issues that have been highlighted there. What I do think, though, is that we are, and what we've been able to get out of that, though, I think particularly in relation to the science, is again another opportunity to work with industry to see how we can improve some of the data gaps that exist. So I think that that has been a positive element of work. I think we had to introduce those interim measures, and that wasn't just coming from us, that came from the industry themselves, recognising the situation that they're seeing and experiencing on the ground. But of course, we have to keep those interim measures under review to ensure they are doing what we need them to do and to look for any potential changes going forward. But we are continuing that engagement with stakeholders. I've been hearing from them directly over the course of the past few weeks in relation to those measures to see how we can continue that collaboration going forward.
Okay, thank you. Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I wanted to ask about resourcing and availability in the Marine Directorate for Spatial Planning. I know it's something that's been discussed for quite a long time, particularly with the 2015 Act, but there have been suggestions that maybe the Directorate doesn't have the resources to take it forward in a meaningful way, so I hope she could speak to that.
Are you meaning in relation to the Marine Planning element of that as well? Well, I'll hand over to Rebecca, who'll probably be able to say a bit more about that. I'm not leading on the development of the new National Marine Plan 2 that's been led by the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero, Gillian Martin, though of course we work closely together on that as well. But I would say there's been specific engagement, I think, with our fishing industry as well to make sure we're getting their views. And I know that these discussions are very much ongoing in relation to the development of a new National Marine Plan. So I wouldn't want to preempt what's going to come out of that engagement process in terms of how we proceed further with that. But I don't know if there's anything further you would want to add, Rebecca.
Yeah, I mean, just to say, we do have a lot of activity underway at the moment in relation to marine planning. So as well as the development of the National Marine Plan 2, which is in a very active phase and where there is a lot of stakeholder engagement happening, as the Cabinet Secretary referenced, we also have ongoing work on regional marine planning, where we're working closely with Clyde, Orkney and Shetland in relation to the development of their regional marine plans, and we hope to be working towards adoption of the first regional marine plan in the not too distant future. It's worth noting that we have had some structural changes in the past couple of years with sectoral planning for offshore wind moving from Marine Directorate, and we now have the Directorate for Offshore Wind, so there's also that sectoral plan being developed for offshore wind, and that's being led by that directorate.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and good morning, panel. I'm interested in finding a wee bit about leveraging additional funding. You know, given the current fiscal constraints that we have, I'm wondering, Cabinet Secretary, are you considering any options for raising additional revenue to support the delivery of the policy ambitions for fisheries? We heard evidence about considering reviewing landing levies or exploring options for leveraging private investment from offshore renewables. Is that something that you're considering?
I think it's really important, and I think especially when we're working within the constraints of the overall budget settlement, as I outlined in my opening comments, that we should try and maximise some of those income streams where we have them as well. I mean, I would just highlight that over the course of the past year, I think we've had about £9 million worth of income generated. So much of that comes from marine licensing fees. Some of that comes from our science work as well. Also with other contracts that we have in relation to compliance and our aerial surveillance and work that we undertake on behalf of the Joint Maritime Security Centre as well. So, yeah, £9 million worth of that so far. But I think it's always important that we keep that under review and look at where else we can look to maximise on any potential income streams.
And I mean, you've just mentioned that you work closely with Gillian Martin Cabsec to look at offshore and marine planning. So is there opportunities just to continue to make sure that good collaboration takes place so that any opportunities can be explored?
Oh, absolutely. And while I outline that some specific responsibilities obviously sit with the other Cabinet Secretary, I mean, of course, with my interest in marine, there is a strong interest there, and we do have close collaboration across these different areas of policy, even though the overall responsibility sits in different portfolios as well. And I think from a directorate perspective, I think it's obviously being able to, I think with the way that it's been established now in that portfolio work, I think it's, I'm sure Rebecca could comment more on how that's working overall and hopefully improving things for the better in that response. Mm-hmm.
Yes, I think just to add, that is one of the advantages of the structure that we have now, that we are really integrated across different areas of activity. So we're working, I think, quite seamlessly across both portfolios, and there's a very close, you know, the issues are ultimately interconnected, and we're able to recognise that in the way that we work. And there is a lot of collaboration across the different areas to think about, you know, the offshore wind elements, biodiversity, and the impact on fisheries when we're thinking about marine planning.
Okay, thanks. Thank you.
We're going to move on to fisheries science. A question from Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary, did you watch the round table that we had on fisheries a couple of weeks ago?
Yes.
Okay, what was your reaction to various academic and former Scottish Government employees in terms of their comments about the downfall of the international reputation of the Scottish scientific output in fisheries?
I mean, obviously, it's really disappointing to hear that, and it's not something you want to hear about the director. And I know that the committee's undertaken visits. You've spoken to some of the team directly, and I think we're fortunate to have some brilliant people right across our marine directorate who are really passionate about what they do and really care about what they do. So, of course, hearing comments like that and hearing that reflection, it's never going to be a nice thing to hear. I mean, some of it, I do think, reflecting on it, is a bit unfair in terms of the criticism that was levelled at the directorate in terms of the science, the reputation there, and the international reputation, because I do genuinely believe that we are well respected and well regarded. I think that when you look at our science, the fact that we have a lead in the number of the working groups and ICs very much played a strong role in the organisation of events that have taken place there. I think we do have strong relationships with different stakeholders and with other academic institutions. So I think that some of the criticism that was levelled, I wouldn't quite agree with in that regard, because I do think that our science and this team of scientists that we have are well regarded.
Okay. I mean, that's really not the picture that was painted. Professor Michael Kaiser from Marine Alliance for Science and Technology for Scotland said that everybody in the past would have liked to have worked at the Marine Lab in Aberdeen, but to be frank, it's not somewhere that you want to work these days, because over three decades it's been systematically hollowed out to shell of what it formerly was. Dr. Robin Cook said it's of real concern that we no longer have a marine institute in Scotland with the capacity to deliver for the future. Those are just a couple of the comments, but the general trend, Cabinet Secretary, as you will be well aware, since 2009, the number of publications that have been produced in Scotland has declined dramatically compared to others. The output in fisheries research in such as Ireland, Denmark, France, and indeed CFAS in the rest of the United Kingdom, and also the budget has decreased. So, you know, it's going to take a very long time, as Dr. Robin Cook said, to get back to the position that we were when actually the science output was quite outstanding, I suppose, pre-2009. I mean, what is your response to that, and what is the Scottish Government going to do to rectify the situation?
Well, I think there are a couple of different things in there. I think you referenced some of the different countries and their output. I mean, obviously, other countries, other administrations within the UK, all of their where Marine sits within their own portfolio areas all operate in a completely different way. So you're not necessarily comparing like with like when you're making those comparisons. I mean, obviously, CFAS operates in a different way to what the Science, Evidence, Data and Digital Department does within the Marine Directorate, where, of course, they do more work externally, receive more of their budget that way, rather than it all being funded by the UK government. So they're funded in a different way. Obviously, the Science Department within the Marine Directorate as well is more focused on the evidence that we need to develop Scottish policy and the interests that we have there. But I do think that, you know, and the committee themselves have visited the Marine Lab, and I think, you know, I accept the points that are made about that. And I would say that, of course, there are a number of short-term measures that have been implemented there, and I realise that the situation is not optimal in terms of you want it to be an attractive place to work in an environment where people want to come and work. But I think that it's also important to highlight that there's a longer-term piece of work that's being developed in relation to that too, where the corporate team within the Scottish Government have put together a project board to look at what potential longer-term options are going to be for the future of that site. But I would also say, in terms of the vacancies that arise, there's a really strong level of interest in filling those as well. So I do still believe that it's an attractive place and a place where people want to work. But there's no doubt that I think when you're looking at the infrastructure in particular, more work needs to be done there. But that's why the work that the project board will be taking forward is really important to add to that. But I would just pass to Nuala, because I don't know if there's anything else you would want to add in relation to that.
Mm-hmm. Just on your final point, in terms of attractiveness of the portfolio for work, just to, as an example, in two recent recruitment exercises, we had application rates of 124 and 87 for posts in chemistry and sea fisheries science posts in particular, which we took as a healthy response to what were relatively junior posts. I think in terms of our publication, we've done an awful lot more in terms of creating open data access alongside our publications record. Our publications, we've published over 1,000 papers since 2010, but we've also published a lot of grey literature. We have our own research series, and also our analytical function produces at least in the range of 15 to 20 papers a day, which are closer to economic advice and to fishery statistics and a range of other publications. So, and we have conference papers, and when we go to ISIS and so on, there's a really wide range of publication destinations just now. In terms of engagement with ISIS in particular, in the past 10 to 15 years, ISIS's own activity has increased fairly drastically as their interests have expanded and their stock assessments have increased. So I think there's over 150 working groups. You know, the Scottish Government is involved in 70 of those, and at different levels and at different levels of influence. I think we're leading on 19 of the stock assessments groups which are currently working, and that compares to 15 years ago we were engaged in around 10. So we've doubled roughly our ISIS engagement over the past 15 years, while at the same time ISIS engagement has got an awful lot more extensive. What we've done in how we've judged where to engage with ISIS is that we have prioritised Scotland's interests in those that we choose to engage most thoroughly in. So I think we're particularly engaged in the emerging stock assessments, which are in the Irish Sea and West of Scotland sector for ISIS. So there's been a positive change over the period, but I would accept it doesn't look the same as it did 15 years ago. Because the nature, and I think academia has changed in this time as well, ISIS has changed, and the demand on all of marine science has certainly increased.
Yeah.
Just jump in there, you talked about assessments. You know, again, we heard about the mismatch between what the government wants the Marine Directorate to be and what it actually can be, given the resources. Mackerel is the most valuable stock for the Scottish fishing industry, accounting for a third of the value of total landings. And there used to be a really strong pelagic team within the fisheries team in the Marine Lab. However, the stock assessments are now being carried out, are being led by the Dutch. So it's no longer people in the marine laboratory that's doing it, and who have in the past invested a huge amount of interest in the fisheries. So, you know, the government's ambitions and desire to be international leader don't appear to be matched by available resources. That's almost a direct quote from what we heard as well. What's your response to that?
I mean, I'll start off on that, and Nuala may want to come in after. But I would say, in relation to mackerel, I mean, that's one example. And, of course, other states have a strong interest in that as well. It's not unusual for other work to be undertaken or led on by other states too. But that's where I would also... But you can pick on that example. But, I mean, I think there's other examples there where Nuala's just talked about the fact that we lead on 19 other stock assessment groups that are important for Scotland. But I think there's also important work to highlight when you look at monkfish and some of the collaboration that took place there. The work that we did in Scotland that led to an increase in the TAC for that species, which was so valuable for our industry. But Nuala, I don't know if there's anything further you want to add there.
I was really going to iterate the 2 points, is that it's standard for ICES to adjust the rules across the different stock assessments, and in particular on the monkfish more recent assessment. The Scottish evidence which led the monkfish assessment has been accepted, and there's now a different stock assessment, and that will lead directly, if it goes through in the ICES way, that will lead to an increase in 30 million in Scottish monkfish income, which is overall 50 million. So we have diverted resources and expertise to where we think they are of most value.
Okay. Rachel, would you like to come back here?
Yes, please. Thanks. Could I ask either the Cabinet Secretary or Nuala Gormley how many publications were reported in 2022-23 from Marine Scotland Science?
I believe those figures, sent that to the committee. It was provided in our letter. I don't know, Nuala, if you have those to hand. Sorry?
Was it 23?
Again, I mean, that could be the figure that was provided to the committee.
Yeah, the figure for 2022-23 was 23.
Yeah. So that's a massive drop. I mean, I know you're trying to say that up to 2010 you had quite a number of publications, you said over 1,000. But actually, in comparison to other institutions, that is very low and leaves Scotland's fisheries in a parlous state. It really does. So, I mean, Are we trying to address here, you also mentioned about junior positions being applied for, but are you saying that we can recover our status right now? What is the plan to do that to support rural and island communities? Because at the moment, the scientific research is, as I say, in a parlous state. What is the plan?
I think it's important to address that point. I mean, you're saying that fisheries are being left in a parlous state, and you're judging that purely on the basis of the number of publications, and I don't think it's fair to make that assessment from the number of publications that are there, because I think what is important is the work that Nuala outlined in relation to the involvement that we have in ICES across these stocks that are important for us in Scotland. And Nuala and I had both touched on the importance of Scottish science feeding into that work, which we saw with monkfish, and we saw a tangible outcome to that, where we saw an increase in the TAC for that species. So it's not fair to necessarily equate the two. And it comes back to another point that I'd made previously about we're not comparing like with like when we look at, you know, external work or work that's done that's potentially published, or I'm sure Nuala will correct me if I'm wrong. I mean, CFAS, again, that we've touched on, operates in a different way. There are other countries who will have their own marine directorates which work in a different way to us. So they may depend more on that external element and work that they're publishing elsewhere. So I just think it's important that, you know, we are making comparisons that are fair, and I don't think that's necessarily the situation with what you've just set out. But, Nuala, I don't know if there's more you would add to that.
I would agree with Cabinet Secretary. I think it's fair to say that the year before 22-23, we had 108 publications, which was the second highest publication rate since 2009. So there is variability across the years. You'll know in the academic sector that different journals take different lengths of time to approve and publish publications. So there is. So we know there's variability across the years. I know myself, since I've come into post, that I've approved a number of publications which are on their way. So we still do have high quality publications on their way.
I'm going to ask one more very quick question. Do you believe that at Marine Scotland Science you have the right skill set in terms of the number, as well as the number of, and the capacity, the number of scientists, and the right amount of funding to be able to continue to ensure that we have or keep up with the reputation of other countries such as Denmark, France, Ireland, Norway?
Yeah. For myself? Yes, I believe that we have excellent scientists and supporting professionals in the said portfolio, and that their resources are prioritised on the obligations that we have that are reflected in the annual delivery plan. I think in terms of skill sets, we continue to make capital investments in new equipment, both on our research vessels and for our laboratories as part of the refurbishment of the laboratory site. And we still do have new scientists coming in, and we are still involved in a range of collaborative PhDs and those kinds of initiatives. So as in many areas, it's an evolving and improving and fine-tuning situation to match the skills to the demand. But I believe we have the processes in place that we are getting that right.
And if I can just add to that as well, I mean, I think what is going to be important is the work that's taken forward of the implementation plan for the science and innovation strategy as well, because I think this isn't about us and our science as part of the main directorate in isolation. But I think, you know, I've mentioned previously about the collaboration and how important that is, and that we get that right. So I think the implementation of the strategy assists us in that.
Okay, well, I don't have a copy, convener, of the budget behind the Marine Directorate Science, Data, Evidence and Digital. I only have separate budgets, so I can't make a judgment on whether that is being funded properly.
It's £16.5 million.
It's right, it's 16. And has it gone up, Cabinet Secretary?
I think that when we're looking at the science budget, it's remained consistent over the course of the past few years.
It is 0.2 million down.
Yeah. But broadly, it's remained consistent.
Right.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Convener. We visited the Marine Lab as a committee, and it was pretty grim, you know, to be fair. And we were at SAMS on Monday, and the contrast couldn't be greater when we saw the working conditions of the staff at the Marine Lab. When do you expect to provide a solution to the issues, just the simple building issues there, which are hampering people's access mm-hmm. to equipment and science?
Oh, that's the thing. It's just as I said earlier, I mean, ultimately, we do want to provide the best available working facilities for people there. So obviously, in light of the damage that was done to the buildings, a number of short-term solutions were put in place. I realise that's not ideal, but that's what I think the work that's being taken forward by the project board in identifying longer-term solutions is going to be really important. But I'm not too clear about what the timescales are for that work. I don't know if officials would have any further information on that.
There's a range of revisions and improvements that will happen in this calendar year, but the strategic work which is taking place with the Marine Lab Project Board are mapping out improvements for the medium and the longer term. So we're in the process of making and taking those decisions. So there are some short-term improvements which are due this year.
So medium to long term, how many years?
Well, on the longer term, I think it's unlikely that if there is any redesign of the overall site, that will take a number of years. That will not be, I think, within 5 years. But actually, the medium-term solutions, which are looking at reproviding the facilities which are currently there, we expect those all being well and subject to budgets in the next few years.
So when will they have labs back on site?
Some of the short-term work, there are still labs on site. The Ellis building still is operational with its labs, and some of the short-term work is looking to restore lab facilities from one of the other buildings. And then there's a there's an alignment of the lab facility on the site. We're still using lab facilities in Aberdeen University as well, and our priority is to try and get enough lab facility back on the site so that we don't need to do that anymore.
So are the labs at Aberdeen University available? Our understanding was that the equipment was there, but they weren't working labs.
As far as I know, those labs are up and running. It takes a while to get all the equipment calibrated and so on, but I think they're as part of the zoology building.
Okay, that wasn't our understanding. Maybe you could...
We'll follow up with the committee on that and double-check that, because I want to make sure, obviously, that we're providing you with the right information.
It would certainly be helpful to find out just exactly what the situation is, because I believe there's also ongoing discussions with the Hutton Institute. So it would be good to get a clear indication of what the future is of that site, but also what, what's been put in place in the meantime.
Mm-hmm. I mean, not having access to some of your labs is obviously having an impact on marine science. What is that impact?
I mean, I don't know if there's further information that Neil can add in relation to that, or if there are particular areas where that's inhibiting work that would have went off.
I think the prioritisation for lab activity is an ongoing exercise alongside the reprovision of the site. I think the main consequence is a build-up of samples. So we have a longer queue of samples needing analysed, so that leads to a delay in the data being available. Some of the capital investments which we're making this year to better equipment is actually equipment that allows us to analyse quicker. So hopefully that will mitigate some of the delay that has been brought about by the problems on the site.
Perhaps I could just add a point of clarification on the laboratories at Aberdeen University. They are operational. The issue is just that they're not accredited yet. So they are able to be used and they are operational in a working sense. It's just that accreditation process that's still underway. But we can write with further details on that.
Yeah. So what difference does that make? One imagines if they're not accredited, you can't really be giving out scientific information from them.
But the accreditation process is underway, so it's just a slight delay at that point. But we are expecting them to be accredited, and that will resolve some of the issues. But the work is still happening there.
Have you got a timescale for that?
We don't have a timescale for the accreditation, but we can keep you updated on that and give an indication.
Okay. It would be good to get some information, because we're also hearing from industry that that's causing problems for them. As well as Rachel Hamilton talked about marine science being an outlier in Scotland with regard to publications, it's also an outlier internationally because it's not independent of government. Do you think that the current structure of the marine science is appropriate? Does it have sufficient resources, and is it independent enough? Because Dr. Robin Cook said to the committee, in laboratories across Europe and indeed North America, science is managed at arm's length from government. The perception among other scientists is that they are more independent organisations. There's a lack of trust among people outside government in Scottish government science because of the fear that it is being manipulated or influenced unduly. How would you respond to that?
I mean, I would absolutely refute that. I mean, I mean, again, there could be benefits. There could also be negative consequences of other models. I mean, I think it would have to do a full comparison to see whether that's something that should be considered. I mean, I think the origins of why we are where we are was that I think around 2009, 2010, it was bringing together various elements of marine policy as well as the compliance. But I mean, I haven't done that work or undertaken that to see what the benefits would be against other operation, what the costs of that would be. So I think... Well, I'm not in a place to make a particular judgment on that as to whether a specific setup of how marine can be set up in another administration would be more or less beneficial to the way that we currently operate at the moment.
But it can't just be, you talked about 2009-10, Since 2009-10, all other comparable institutions' output has increased, with a slight dip in the last 2 years. Since 2009-10, Marine Science Scotland's output has dipped. So it's not in line with international institutions. Could that really be, and will you reconsider maybe the structure of the organisation? Is it independent enough? Can it raise enough funds from out with government? Because while you've talked about, in real terms, funding has fallen.
Well, I've talked about some of the income that's been generated through that. So I think I'd be right in saying about £3.5 million worth of the £9 million in income has come from other scientific work, I believe. But again, a full analysis of that would have to be undertaken. I mean, Rebecca had already outlined the restructure that had taken place last year. I think we need to consider how that is operating, but in terms of how the department itself operates and moving for that, I mean, that's largely operational and for the Marine Directorate itself to look at where those resources are and how that is aligned. But I think what's important for me is, I mean, there's no question about the independence of our scientists and the work that they undertake. What's important for me is that we're seeing the outcomes and where that's beneficial for Scotland. We've already talked at length today about the engagement, the involvement with ICES across all the different stock assessments, those areas that are particularly that are most valuable for us and the work that's undertaken there. And I think that's what's really important for me to see, and that we do then see the benefit from that.
But it doesn't concern you that it seems to be in decline when compared to other international institutions?
Again, I think that you can take a narrow view and look at the overall publications, but I think we need to look at this more widely. I feel like the number of publications that are being published is being used as the measure of how the directorate is performing, and I don't think that's a fair assessment. I think especially when Nuala talked about the increased involvement that we have in ICES and the expertise that's being utilised there. So I think we need to consider all of this in the round.
I hear what you're saying, but actually it's surprising to me that they're able to publish anything, having seen the conditions they're working in. And I just find it concerning that you don't think there's an issue there.
I haven't said that at all today, and I would want to clarify that, because I recognise the issues that exist with the Marine Lab, and I hope I've been quite clear and transparent about that today. And there has to be work undertaken there, because as I've said, we want that to be a place that people feel proud and enthusiastic to work in, and we want to make sure that we have the best available facilities for staff to work in too. But that's where the work of the project board and delivering what that future looks like is going to be really important, and as we've already set out, that's where we'll be happy to furnish the committee with further information on that.
Just before we move on, much of the information that we've been looking at has come from Paul Fernandez from Heriot Watt University. And on a paper he's published, he is saying that what we're seeing indicates that Fisheries Research MSS, unlike equivalent institutions, has been in decline for over a decade and is now at very low levels. Resulting in amount and quality of research in the traditional core areas of fishery has diminished. So Cabinet said, do you not agree that without adequate understanding of their demise, nor appropriate scientific research into how they might recover, their status and those of rural and island communities that it depends on them remains in the balance?
I mean, our fishery science is, of course, hugely important, and I understand some of the concerns that were raised. I've acknowledged that, but I would say that when you look at our spend, particularly in fishery science, I know it hasn't increased, but it's remained broadly consistent over the course of the past few years. And I think all the work that we've previously talked about, I'm not going to reiterate and go over that again today, but you know, we've already talked about some of the positive examples of the work that we've seen. And as in relation to monkfish as an example of that, and all the engagement that there is through ICES, and ultimately trying to ensure we're seeing the best outcomes and fishing opportunities for our industry in Scotland. But of course, we can't do all of that on our own. I've already talked today about the science and innovation strategy, the development of the implementation plan for that. And again, that's going to be a critical component, because that's how we can really try and use our resources best we can in collaboration with other academic institutions, as well as together with working with industry.
Okay. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. Just picking up on what you just said in that last point about using the Scottish Government's resource as best as you can and in collaboration with other academic institutes, we, as Rhoda Grant mentioned earlier, we visited SAMHS, Scottish Association for Marine Science, and they do incredible work around ocean systems, climate change, marine conservation, aquaculture and food security. And as Rhoda said, it was a well, I actually hadn't visited the directorate, science directorate, but Rhoda had, and other colleagues have mentioned, and we've heard today, the challenging situation in Aberdeen. And SAMHS is an absolutely contrast experience from what I hear. No one's doubting the team of scientists at Marine Directorate Science. They're doing a good job, but in a challenging situation. But it was raised to us at SAMHS whether they could be brought more closely in and if more of Scottish Government's resource could be used in that kind of collaborative way. It was a very impressive meeting that we had with them. We saw many of their facilities, and I know that the Scottish Government Marine Directorate does bring them in from time to time, but I think they are looking for an opportunity to bring some of their academic, I would say, brilliance into the mix. And I think it's an incredible offer that they have on the west coast of Scotland and a lot of good work that's being done there.
Oh, absolutely. And I think especially, you know, the openness to that collaboration. And I think that's definitely, yeah, where we can look to strengthen those relationships and collaborate more closely. We would absolutely look to do that. And again, I think that just comes back to, you know, the implementation, how we're delivering on what we've set out in the science and innovation strategy to make sure that we're maximising our resources in the best way that we can and really utilising that expertise that exists elsewhere.
We're going to move on to compliance and enforcement. Questions from Christine Graham.
Thank you very much. Good morning. I'm new to this, so I'll put a little narrative and then my questions from what I have. My understanding is that the Marine Directorate budget is the largest proportional share goes to compliance and enforcement, some 37% from 2009-10 to 2022-23. That's what I have here. And that part of that enforcement is you have, and I'll just get my glasses here, you have 3 marine protection vessels and 2 aircraft, but you also, which also uses remote electronic monitoring. And that, further to just putting the sort of stall out, that there are 150 non-UK vessels fishing pelagic species in Scottish waters throughout the year. I don't have the figure for the UK ones, so I would like to know that. And so my questions flow from these. I may have other bits to add. Can you tell me what the budget is? And are they separate for compliance and enforcement? So, or are they one and the same? And can you tell me how old the marine protection vessels and aircraft are and how much it costs for them? Because it seems, and I appreciate, it's a huge area, but these seem to be inadequate and quite expensive. So I'd kind of like to know the figure for that. And in terms of the business of ensuring compliance, it seems to me the non-UK vessels get off lightly because it's easier with the UK ones because they'll be registered and licensed. So how does that work in when people are breaking the rules? Because as I understand it, damage is being done. And it appears to be, from what I have in my notes here, that in terms of dissuading people, of course, compliance will save you having to go to enforcement, which is more costly, I would think, that damage is still being done to the fish stock and the seabed, undoubtedly. So, you know, how do we deal with this, you know, the non-UK ones? And also, what are we going to... I mean, these ageing vessels, once I know their age, what's a better way of doing it? I don't understand how remote electronic monitoring works, so maybe if you could just tell me how it works with non-UK vessels in particular. And the fact that the level of fines at the end of the day doesn't appear to be making their mark. I mean, you can just as well break the law and make more money doing that than, and then pay the fine. So there's my list of questions.
There's... quite a lot to unpick in that.
Wanted to do it in a sort of stream, yeah, so that you follow my train of thought.
I will try to as much as possible, but if I do forget a point, please do pick me up on it. I think one thing I want to point out, first of all, you mentioned remote electronic monitoring. So I appeared in front of the committee not that long ago to introduce those regulations. So the REM is being rolled out across particular sections of our fleet, not across the whole fleet. It's pelagic vessels and scallop dredge vessels as well. The pelagic measures don't come into force until 2026 to give the industry time to adjust and prepare for that. But what I would say is that when we introduce REM on our own vessels, it also applies to vessels fishing in Scottish waters as well.
Well, how does it work, though? Is there something on the vessel that sends a signal? I don't understand.
Yeah, well, there's a difference between VMS and REM. So I think all vessels are equipped, or over 12 metres are equipped with VMS. We're looking to roll out VMS across our whole fleet by the end of the parliamentary term. Okay. We'd undertaken a consultation on that, and we're still to publish the outcome of that. REM is more detailed. REM is about winch sensors, about camera footage. It's different for different parts of the fleet. So I mentioned the pelagic vessels, it could be a different setup there to what is on the scallop dredge vessels. So, but again, I'd be happy to furnish you with the exact information, but it essentially provides us with more detail and more information. And again, it would apply to vessels that are fishing in Scottish waters.
And non-UK
vessels, yeah. Right. I think that was really important. We wanted to make sure with the rollout of REM that you weren't seen to just implement that on Scottish vessels or UK vessels. It's important that that applies across the piece. So just to be clear in relation to that. You also touched on our vessels there and the fleet. You're absolutely right. We have three marine protection vessels. We have two marine research vessels. We have two aeroplanes. We also have, I think it's 18 fisheries offices, as well as, I think it's two rib boats that we have as well. So it is quite a large fleet that we have, and of course there's the expense that comes with that. I think I would just set out, you did ask about the budget in relation to that. Compliance had its own line in the budget up until until last year and this year, where it falls under the operational delivery line of the budget, against which we have £29.3 million of that available for this year. Now, of course, with the vessels, I think some of the costs that we've seen there have escalated in the past few years. I think fuel in particular, staff costs, general maintenance and running costs, even if you compare them to the likes of, just from 2021 to 2022, I think are, when you're looking at overall operational costs of the vessels, it's gone up by about £2.5 million as well. And I think fuel, particularly since the illegal invasion of Ukraine, has led to quite huge increases in the overall fuel bill. I think we saw an increase in £1.5 million over one financial year, and the fuel costs are still 30% higher than they were prior to invasion of Ukraine. You talked about the age of the vessels.
No,
of course.
Oh,
yes.
Before you move on, I'm just trying to, simple person, I've got a compliance figure, £29.3 million. I don't have an enforcement figure. Is there such a thing as the cost of enforcement? Hear everything you say about the fuel costs, everything else. But I take it that all comes under enforcement, the people who are... Do we have a figure for that, or is the £29.3 million
That's
both?
That's isn't it?
We have cost breakdowns in terms of the staffing costs and the operational costs for the vessels. So we can provide a detailed breakdown of the different aspects of the enforcement budget.
Just an umbrella cost for something that you might define as enforcement.
Well, I think in terms of operating the operational costs of the vessels, that would be for the last financial year, that was £12.376 million. So that was made up of both the staffing costs and the running costs of the vessels.
So that's additionally to the 29.3 that we have already for compliance.
Well, that would be a part of that overall budget.
I'm trying to understand this, because there isn't a compliance and enforcement budget or line. They're separated out, and obviously they can't really disentangle them, because compliance depends how effective you are with your enforcement. But, it was to try to get a figure for what the cost is. I'm not saying they're not doing a good job, I just want to know what the cost is. So if you could just let me know what that would be, because this is a huge bit of the Marine Directorate's budget.
Yes, and it has...
And if you can't just now, I mean, maybe just write to the committee and let me know that in simple terms, what's this costing to make sure that illegality is not taking place in our seas?
Yes, certainly.
So that was that. What was the other one? I've lost track of some own questions now. Oh, yes.
The age of the vessels.
The age, yes. How old are they?
I think NULA has the age for all the vessels that we have there. We do have two that are probably approaching their end of service life age. So the two that are in that category are the Marine Research Vessel Scotia, which is 26 years, right, and the Minna, which is a Marine Protection Vessel, which is 21 years.
What about the aircraft? Are they...
I don't have the age of the aircraft. I don't know if that's information that NULA has. Or we
I'm just looking at when you're going to have to replace them,
yes,
or use something else.
And that's what we're planning for as well. So we're aiming to go to procurement for those two vessels that I've mentioned next year.
Can REM or the other more technological things replace, to some extent, having... What, I don't use the word clunky, but old-fashioned things like aircraft and boats sailing about looking for mischief. Mm-hmm. You know, will that ever replace it? So you really, apart from them going out and, you know, doing something, will they ever replace it? We use these more technical systems.
Oh, absolutely. We're looking at that all the time and how we can ultimately be more efficient and use new technology to our advantage. So I think there's a number of different areas we can look at there. So I think one is in terms of, well, even logbooks and having them submitted digitally. I think over the course of the last year, I think only about 3.5% of the Fish One logbooks were submitted electronically. That's now up to over 12%. So people in the fisheries offices are clearly looking to encourage that and to see more of that. In relation to our marine protection vessels and technology we're looking at there too, I was actually visiting one of the marine protection vessels a few months ago to look at a pilot that they're undertaking with drone technology. Which is, I think,
drones,
has the potential to be really exciting, actually, and quite transformative. We've already discussed REM, and I think that will provide a number of benefits, I think, particularly in relation to, I think, some issues that we've seen and capabilities in terms of overall compliance there too. So I think that, as I mentioned, there are a few different areas there, but we're always looking to see how we can really use new technology to the best possible advantage. And ultimately, I mean, even with the three vessels, the two ribs, the aerial surveillance, you can't be everywhere all the time at once, and we have quite a vast marine area around our coastline to try and monitor. So that's where all these new technologies can really help and assist us with that.
And then another, thank you, I should have thought of drones. Of course, we're fighting wars with drones now horrendously, so obviously that's a technology. And there's been expression that, in fact, at the end of the day, the levels of fines, even if you catch people, they're not deterring illegal activity. So what's your comment about that? Because that just costs you more money each time.
No, you're absolutely right. We'd actually made a commitment as part of our fisheries management strategy that was published a few years ago that we would undertake a review of penalties. And we actually have a survey that's live at the moment, which is asking questions about that. And that survey is open until the end of September. Because I do think it's absolutely right. We've got to make sure they're at a proportionate level. So we just want to highlight that work is underway and that we're gathering views on that.
Convener, do we know what the level of fines is? Do we have information about that?
I don't have it in front of me. Certainly, we've had some witnesses who suggest that the level of fines is not...
Yeah, just looking for a number.
Not a deterrent.
You know, I've got no idea. Where would we find what you, I mean, is it a set-down statutory level of fines for various...
There's
things?
A scale for that, yeah, but I'd be happy to provide the committee with
quite
that information.
I'd quite like to see that, because if we're being told it's not high enough, then it has to change. Mm-hmm. Because that's deterring the people who are actually obeying the law, which is wrong that others get away. I don't know if I have anything else. Perhaps the supplementaries, I might want to come back in because I'm trying to find my way through this.
Yeah, I think something that would be helpful to ask is whether you are actively reviewing the level of fines at the moment, if that's something you look at over the next
Yeah, just as I've outlined, we've actually got a survey that's live at the moment which is looking for attitudes towards compliance, and there are questions in that around penalties too. So as I said, that survey is going to be live until the end of this month, so we'll be able to provide further information after that point.
Which is, how successful are you? I mean, obviously you've got to have that evidence to find someone. How successful is such a percentage hit rate?
I don't know if officials would have that information to hand, and I'm happy to provide it to the committee afterwards. Again, I think by all the technologies we've talked about today, I think can help us deal with some of the issues that we see that we're not able to tackle at the moment. So, as I mentioned, the rollout of REM will really help assist us with that. I don't know if it'd be helpful. I mean, I have the overall figure in the course of last year of what we received in fixed penalty notices. That was about £140,000. But again, in terms of the detail of that and the number against the number of cases that we get reports on, I'd be happy to provide a further breakdown to the committee.
Does seem a lot of money when you're looking at millions that you're having to do for compliance and enforcement. £140,000 isn't an awful lot. Does that get ploughed back into the budget?
It goes into the consolidated fund.
The last thing I want to ask, and it is the last thing, convener, is if you were to move, are you projecting the savings that could be made to the compliance and enforcement budget if you make that transition to more technology instead of aircraft in the sky, the drones, the electronic monitoring? Are you able to project, maybe it's early days, savings that could be made to this very, very, you know, large budget for that particular thing, compliance and enforcement?
I wouldn't be able to project that at the moment as well, because I think regardless of some of the technologies at the very early stages, okay, we haven't seen the wider rollout of that yet. But also it is still important that we have our marine protection vessels and our research vessels as well. So there will still be that ongoing cost. But I do think that in terms of the procurement with that, the types of vessels, I think it offers us new opportunities there as well. So I can't necessarily say it provides a saving at this time.
Thank you very much.
But yeah, we certainly want to utilise the opportunities that exist.
Thank you, Ms Graham. We'll now move on to theme five, collaboration and co-management, and a question from Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, convener, and I just want to appreciate the line of questioning from Christine Graham. I thought that was very useful. So again, we had that stakeholders roundtable, which was very, again, also very useful. And at that session, stakeholders spoke about the importance of investigating and resourcing in regional fisheries governance and co-management structures. So we heard from a number of people, and I'll just give you a couple of flavours of it. So we heard from Alistair Hamilton, who was a representative from the Regional Inshore Fishery Group Network, and he said that more local control would get community buy-in and increase compliance, because what is happening would be known as opposed to what we have at the moment with the remote service. And then Professor Cook also went on to say that in America, they ensure that the evidence on which the management is predicated is shared, so that instead of presenting people with an assessment of science evidence and saying, we're going to do this, what do you think? They go in at a lower level where the industry itself is involved in preparing the evidence on which the management decisions are made. As a result, they get much more buy-in to the whole process. So I'd be interested to hear what work is being done by the Scottish Government to review the existing regional networks, including looking at co-management models in other jurisdictions to inform potential reform of regional fisheries management in Scotland. And I think I'll just add that we did also hear about the FMAC and the subgroups and some degree of frustration and also kind of lack of movement in some of those subgroups. So just to kind of point that out. So looking at the co-management models, but also if there's scope for increasing investment and providing more local powers to support fisheries co-management. So we've also been made aware of the models, I think they're called IFCAs in England, which mm-hmm. are based out of local authorities, but have that more local control focus.
You've raised a lot of really interesting points, and I think it chimes with a lot of the work that is ongoing at the moment. Of course, IFCAs are a separate model in a completely different setup there. But I think one thing that I would say is that we've been in a process of change over the course of the past few years in relation to putting FMAC on a more structured footing than what it had been previously, also in relation to the regional inshore fisheries groups as well. And I've been involved in a number of different meetings with stakeholders over the course of the past few weeks, and I think hearing the different frustrations that exist with people. Now, we have been undertaking a review of FMAC to determine how that's been working, how different stakeholders are finding the operation of that format, and we're also looking at regional inshore fisheries groups and how that's been operating too. So I think the feedback that we get as a result of that will then help us determine a way forward as well. But I touched on in a previous response to, I think, the overall roadmap to change for inshore fisheries that we're embarking on. The interim measures were, you know, one of the steps in relation to that. We also heard quite clearly from stakeholders that, of course, they want to be involved in that change, and we're intending to hold a call for evidence potentially towards the end of this year to seek views on models going forward and how we can best really maximise that engagement. So I'd be happy to keep the committee on that work as we progress with it. And now, we have had a couple of inshore fisheries pilots as well that have been working really well, so I think it's really important we take the learning from those. They're still ongoing at the moment, and that can then help inform the process that we're going through too. But I recognise the points that you've made, and I think we are keen to see that more, I think, regional approach to management.
You refer to these inshore fisheries pilots. Just to be clear, which ones did you have in mind?
There is one that's in Mull at the moment, and I would have to find details. I'd be happy to provide more information if that's helpful, because I don't have that to hand.
And in terms of the call for evidence on looking at different models, what's the timescale on that?
Again, as I say, we're going to be having that call for evidence potentially towards the end of this year, but we're very much working with stakeholders on that. But again, as the timescales become a bit more definitive, I'd be happy to provide you with that information.
Have you done any work looking at the IFCA model, the model based in England? A lot of people seem to point to it as being a really valuable, useful model. Have you ever looked into that?
I would have to ask officials if they've looked at that in detail. Again, I don't have that to hand, or certainly information on IFCA's to hand.
Okay, if you could update us on that,
that would
be great.
Just on that, can you give us a little bit better indication of timescales? The issue surrounding inshore fisheries groups was raised in the Rain Committee in the previous sessions in Parliament, but there doesn't seem to be a lot of progress. Can you give us a better indication of, and I know you're saying there's going to be a consultation, whatever happens, but where's your target to actually get some final details about how our regional inshore fisheries groups will look?
I would say that since the last session, there had also been a review of regional inshore fisheries groups and some changes made within the course of the past few years. So it's really been a case of looking at how those changes have been implemented as well. But again, we want to make sure that we're working with our stakeholders on this process. So, again, as soon as timescales are more clearer on that, I will provide the committee with that information.
OK, I just want to correct the report. It was the CLEAR committee rather than the RAIN committee that was looking at it. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Now, we're going to move on to the next theme, access to information in the Marine Directorate budget and research programmes. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks. And just before I move on to that theme, just on the other theme about co-management collaboration, I think it's important that you are looking at this work, because there's so many different fora like FMAC, RIFGs, national marine plans. I think there's something else as well. I mean, it's a very confusing landscape for people to kind of engage with and know where they can go to get their voice heard.
Absolutely. And I think because there is a lot going on in this space as well, that we're very much being guided by stakeholders as to how to form and develop that process from here. So, again, that's why, you know, we've heard quite clearly that by implementing the step of having a call for evidence before we then formally consult on measures, that stakeholders would find that the most helpful and engaging. So I would say that we are working closely with them, because we recognise there is a lot happening in this space at the moment, and we do really want to take stakeholders with us.
Okay, thanks for that. So on access to information on Marine Directorate budget and research programmes, so we've heard from stakeholders that there's a lack of detail and transparency in the information on Marine Directorate budgets and research activity, and you previously told the committee that work is underway to review what information the Marine Directorate will proactively publish. You said, as for the point about transparency as a directorate, we are looking at what information we can more proactively publish ahead of time so that it is there and can be accessed readily by stakeholders. And that piece of work is underway. Could you commit to publishing more detailed annual information on Marine Directorate budget spending and research activity?
I'm more than happy to consider those different issues. I mean, I think when we touched on that a couple of weeks ago, I think it highlighted one example in particular where, you know, we look to proactively publish information. I think that was about the overall level of inspections, and we've been doing that for a few years now and trying to be more transparent within that. And it was an area that we received a lot of queries. So I'm more than happy to consider looking at that. I know that there are a number of open data sets that we have at the moment. We do have a huge volume of information pages and documents that are published and made publicly available, but I suppose that's largely in relation to our marine licensing, planning and outcomes of marine assessments as well. I think if there are particular areas where you feel like there isn't that information being published that you feel should be, then please do let me know if there are any particular concerns there. But I think, you know, we certainly publish the peer-reviewed scientific papers, we have our official statistics and all of that too.
I think one of the things that's come up as well is that there, even with data that is published, it's not that user-friendly. It kind of comes up in different forms, and it's a lot of work for people who want to kind of analyse it, who are maybe doing it on a volunteer basis or even, you know, within the industry to kind of put it together. So if there's something that we could do about actually making it not only public but
user-friendly.
More user-friendly, yeah. Exactly, would be great. So
absolutely, take that point on
taking
board.
That on. Yeah. Just to go into a little bit more detail, so again, one of the stakeholders that was at the roundtable was Open Seas, and they raised they had a submission before the roundtable, and they raised a point about the Marine Fund payments of over 500,000 to commercial subsidiaries of the Scottish Fishermen Federation to collect fisheries observer data, and they note that there's a concern there about the use of public funding because the Fishermen's Federation is not purely a research organisation. The data has not yet been published, and the data could be collected more easily by REM, which could potentially influence the Federation's support for that policy. And also, finally, that there's little transparency on how this large sum of money is actually being spent. Would you be able to address these points? I know they're quite detailed, or provide more information on the detail of the projects, those project costs at some point.
Yeah, that's fine. I'm happy to provide the committee with further information. I don't have all of that detail to hand at the moment. But, I mean, one thing that I would highlight about that programme, we talked previously when we were discussing science and collaboration, and I do think that that's a really important piece of work that we do with SFF that they're able to assist us in as well. But, again, I'll have to follow up with more information to the committee.
Yeah. And finally, just on, I'm just interested to understand why the Scottish Government chose to spend money on the judicial review appeal that you had with Open Seas. This NGO and others are concerned that they're trying to hold the government to account to obligations that we have, that the government has. And they won, and it's kind of like, why is the government not actually carrying out its obligations rather than spending money on appealing that kind of situation?
I think because we felt that we had grounds to appeal that decision, which is ultimately why we did. Now, I do appreciate that that uses more resource when we decide that that's the way forward that we're going to proceed with, but I think that we believed that we had grounds for the basis of appeal, and that's why we appealed that decision.
But isn't it a slippery slope if we start to, they won, and it was about asking the government to uphold the obligations that we have in legislation around our seas. Surely that's something that we should should be accepted and responded to in a positive and constructive way rather than appealing it.
Well, again, I think it's, I mean, I can't, I don't think that's as good to use, I think, that case in terms of how we should respond to all elements of a judicial review. I mean, obviously these things have to be judged on a case-by-case basis. I mean, it's not the case that we appeal every single judicial review if it's, say, if it's an outcome that we may not have agreed with, if we don't believe that we have the basis for an appeal. So again, all of this is determined on a case-by-case basis.
Thank you. Before we move on to overarching rural issues, I think we should pause for a comfort break for 5 minutes, and if we resume just shortly after 10:50. OK, we're now going to move on to the broader themes of the Rural Affairs Budget and overarching rural issues and questions from Rachel Hamilton.
The committee have heard, Cabinet Secretary, that defunding and realigning from the rural budget to others has actually had a significant impact on the supply chains for land managers and those operating in rural areas. So, for example, the nature restoration funding, which was reprioritised to fund council payday deals earlier this year. Do you envisage, firstly, that the same thing happening next year with another pot of rural money? And how can the government understand the impact on the stakeholders that I've just mentioned?
In terms of the realigning of other budgets to other areas, I don't know if you've got any particular references to this portfolio where that's a concern, because the Nature Restoration Fund isn't funded by my portfolio or my portfolio funding. So I think I would just want to make that clear.
OK, but let's talk about the £46 million then.
Yeah. Absolutely. And I firstly just want to apologise. I sent a letter to the committee last night, which hopefully set out some of that information. It is information that we'd also provided earlier in the year and at previous sessions too. So firstly, to apologise for the lateness of that, but I think just to set out exactly where we are in relation to that funding. Now, overall, the committee will no doubt be aware, we've discussed it at some length previously, about the £61 million in savings that had been offered over the course of the two previous financial years. Those were largely from unspent funds, from demand-led funds that weren't spent. I would say that our priority in the budget throughout all of this is to ultimately protect that investment that we're making in rural and island communities and in the payments that we're making to farmers. So there were no cuts from funds in that sense. Again, they were largely demand-led unspent funds that were then offered as savings to meet the general pressures that were... every directorate was asked to meet with the overall budget pressures that we faced over the course of the past financial years. Again, it's not possible for me to say what savings are going to look like or at any point in the future, because we don't know what a budget is going to look like next year. So I can't make that assessment.
Well, I think you can make that assessment, because in the letter that you sent, you said that the £46.1 million remains to be returned to the portfolio, and further details of this return will continue to be set out in Scottish Budget 2025-26. So there is an indication that you know something of what's going on. But in terms of the uncommitted spend, do you plan to move any other parts from the rural budget in uncommitted spend in the future for the 2025-26 budget?
Again, I don't know what the detail of that budget is, so I said in the letter, you're absolutely right, that I'll be providing more detail, but I need to know what budget I've got. And for those, obviously we haven't had the UK spending review, we don't know what any of that is going to look like yet or what the quantum is going to be.
But the problem is that I think that there are questions further on about BEW, but the language in the letter... I've noted that table one on page one implies that ring-fenced and BEW are two separate issues. However, phrasing in the rest of the letter actually implies that ring-fenced and BEW are merged into the total agri budget. So I think it just remains that the £46 million has been removed and that this letter was even more confusing than... I originally thought that the whole scenario was, so that's a shame. So how much research... You didn't answer the question around the impact, because normally in this scenario, in any scenario where policy is made, a BRIA is made and the impact assessment is made of what happens on the ground, grassroots, supply chains. Have you undertaken any assessment of your current payment strategy, your current budget and prioritisation is having on rural communities?
I think, first of all, I just want to touch on the letter, and apologies if you find it more confusing than it was initially. I don't know if there are follow-up questions in relation to that, that we can help furnish the committee with more information, I'm more than happy to do that as well. In relation to the overall to impact assessments, I think were there any changes, those impact assessments are taken out as a matter of course. I mean, you'll be aware of some of the savings that had been announced by the Finance Secretary at the start of this month as well, and I believe that impact assessments are due to be published in relation to that. So whatever those decisions are taken, then the impacts would be set out. And of course, we also have the obligations under the Islands Act to produce an Island Communities Impact Assessment in relation to any impact that we perceive would be there.
Yes, and I think that is an important thing because it is a statutory requirement to acknowledge what is expected of, for example, the UNCRC or the Islands Act on any budgetary considerations. Do you think that, in general, rural areas, there should be sort of rural proofing? Because it is easy for the government to look at uncommitted spending, remove it and put it into something else, such as the nature restoration budget, which will have an impact on rural communities. I mean, you know, the $46 million being removed, farmers are angry about that. The nature restoration budget to pay for public sector pay increases, people were angry about that in rural communities. You say that there's going to be an impact assessment alongside the budget, but will it specifically address the removal of that $46 million and the removal of the nature restoration funding?
I think we're conflating a few different issues there. So, as I said, well, $46 million is what's due to be returned from the overall £61 million in quantum of the ring fence funding. So, again, that was from unspent funds, and I've outlined where that was there. So, in theory, some of that didn't have an impact because it was money that wasn't going to be spent. Now, I understand the more general point that you're trying to make, where you've referenced the Nature Restoration Fund as an example. If we don't have that fund in place, then we can't then fund the extra activities that will help us reduce emissions and enhance nature. It means that we're naturally able to do less with less funding. I think, well, an example of that, and again, not where we would want to be, is the fact that we haven't been able to run an FPMC grant round over the course of the past couple of years because of the nature of the budget situation that we find ourselves in. And we know that that will have an impact by the fact that people will not be able to necessarily invest in the way that they would want to. But again, in relation to that, I just wouldn't want us to conflate what has been the unspent funding that is due to be returned with pots of funding in other portfolios that have been utilised for another purpose.
I suppose the way to look at it would be it's an SNP policy to reduce child poverty. But how do we know that, you know, even if it's an uncommitted spend, that the removal of that is not having a direct impact on rural communities and child poverty, for example? How do you know, do you do a comparison between rural and island and, well, I suppose you look at island specifically, but sort of rural and central belt, because I'm trying to work out how this budget is meaningfully making an impact in rural areas or negatively making an impact. And I think it's important when you're around the table with the cabinet that when you make your case, that cabinet secretary, you can say, sorry to keep using the word you, but the cabinet secretary can continue to make the case to say that this is going to have a direct impact if you remove this money, even if it was uncommitted.
Mm-hmm. I think it brings me back to, I think, another point that you touched on when we were referring to the Island Communities Impact Assessment. I think that, one, we have some helpful tools that help us in relation to that. I talked a few weeks ago about the work that's being undertaken for a rural delivery plan and some of the mechanisms that we're looking at through that work, which I think will help us address some of those issues. And I think I referenced then the rural data dashboard as well as helping to look at some of that information. I think I accept the wider point that you're making. It's about ensuring that there isn't a disproportionate impact on people who live in rural and island communities. And of course, that is my role.
Yeah. I just want to touch very briefly on the payment strategy, which is the government's payment strategy. I'm just wondering what research has been done to ensure that payment strategy is future-proofed and avoids any missed payments.
Oh, sorry, George. I, 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 I don't understand, or if there's a particular issue with it.
It's just on the Scottish rural payment system currently missing opportunities to fulfil national policy and strategy aims. That there's various people who are sort of making the point that some of the national outcomes are not being met because the payment strategy isn't being adhered to. I suppose it's expanding on the points that I'm trying to make.
Sorry, I don't know if you mean the actual... I mean, we publish a payment strategy, whether you mean that specifically.
Yeah.
Because that largely just sets out the targets by which we intend to make payments and when we expect all those payments to be completed. So we have been adhering to that. So, sorry, I'm not quite clear on what the issue is.
So, for example, if stakeholders had there was a low take-up of some of the schemes, and they, you know, the payment strategy, I suppose, was out of kilter, has there been any research into... changing that timeline or changing the payment strategy because there was a low uptake, or what are you going to do to ensure that there is a good uptake so that you can make the most of what you're trying to achieve in terms of that payment strategy?
I think, again, we're at risk of conflating several different things. The payment strategy sets out when applications will come in, when the payments will be made. We met that last year. We are currently ahead of a target for it for this year, as the Cabinet Secretary said earlier. The first payments this year for basic payments and greening went out at the beginning of September. Now, that's at least a week earlier than last year and several weeks earlier than the past. So we are more than meeting the payment strategy. The payment strategy is not about what level of uptake there will be for schemes, for instance, under the National Test Programme, carbon audits and soil testing. It's about, are we in government doing what we need to do quickly enough to get the payments out so that no one is waiting longer than they should be for their money?
So you're saying that the two are not connected. So, for example, if you had the soil testing scheme, which 6 months ago had a very low uptake... So it has improved because there was a very low uptake when we were scrutinising the agricultural bill.
I think we've had, for the set of measures, over 3,500 claims last year. There's the numbers are coming in this year because we make that scheme, and I think we've discussed this before, as flexible as possible, so we're not requiring people to apply in advance and get approval. They simply get the work done, then come to us for payment, and they've got until the end of the financial year to make their claim. So we know that there is a hockey stick in terms of when the claims come in. So that that system has been done for the benefit, for the convenience of the farmers.
Just to be clear for this committee, if there's a pot of funding, let's just use soil testing.
Yep.
You're saying that pot of funding has been, there's been, a high uptake, an over subscription to that? Is that what you're saying?
No. I think I was addressing the point that you made, that there had been a low uptake for that, and in fact the figures that we have suggest that last year there was a quite considerable uptake, certainly higher than the year before, and there are claims coming through in the current financial year. We know as well that the uptake through the Farm Advisory Service for some of their particular audits has been very high. So we are seeing evidence of off that.
Okay, so that's just to push this. So the funding that has been allocated for some of the, shall I call them greening schemes or other schemes that possibly will become conditional on receiving future payments, all of those schemes are being taken up and the funding that was allocated for them has been used. Is that what you're saying?
I wouldn't want us to confuse a variety of different issues here. I think if there are particular... We have some demand-led schemes. So just as George was talking about, the National Test Programme and the Preparing for Sustainable Farming has been one of those schemes. where, yes, uptake was low when it initially started, but it's gradually been building. So, of course, we have to budget what we think we're going to use for that year. But, again, it depends on the various different schemes that we have, and the payment strategy is separate to all of that.
Yeah. I mean, I'm just looking at the strategy timetable. It just would be interesting to know. I've only got the figures from the 9th February 2024, and the regulatory target is 95.24% of all these different schemes. But it's kind of, I suppose I'm trying to work out, you know, how is that regulatory target in all of those areas being met?
Yes.
Yes. Right. Okay. And then the residual cash. I presume that's allocated. That gets reprioritised, does it? Or does it roll over?
Again, I think we're at the risk of. So the payment strategy is around things like the basic payment scheme and greening. And as you say, there is a target that by, you know, for some of them we have interim targets. You know how much we would have done by December, and then further targets for what we have to have done by the end of the year. Anything, so you know, you used a figure there of 95.24%. The remaining couple of percent is not money that we can reprioritise. That is usually somewhere where there is an issue with the person's application and claim that is still getting sorted out. So they're still due that money, but until that is resolved, it doesn't get paid out. So there is always and it is a very small tail of older cases like that still work through the system, and they will get in due course, if they're eligible for it, their payment, and that will be that will be assigned to the year in which they're.
Okay, so we can be confident in this committee that the money allocated to SRDP, that 5%, extra 5%, I use the word loosely, it goes to 100% basically.
So those targets are about basically government doing its job, processing cases timiously, getting the money out. You know, we are now, I think, on those schemes sitting somewhere over the 99.5%. That means there are still a handful of cases that are outstanding. Looking then at things like the carbon audits and soil testing, yes, those are demand-led budgets. In previous years, we would have created estimates at the beginning of the year of the likely uptake, and we were monitoring that. That is one of the areas, the letter that you referred to from one of the previous years, the uptake was not so high. So there was we recognised in year that we weren't going to spend all that money. That was then used as a saving, but with the condition, the clarification that money was and is going to return to the portfolio. So it's not money that is being lost to the rural economy. Farmers, landowners at the time chose not to apply to it, but the money is still there for us to bring into the system.
Okay, thank you.
Just some more questions. Sadly, I accept your apology, Cabinet Secretary, for the lateness of this letter came in, but it does raise more questions than it answers in some instances. So the letter that you wrote outlining the £620.7 million of ring-fence money, there is no indication of what the Scottish Government's contribution is to the overall budget in that. Which would have been helpful to actually see the whole makeup of what the portfolio budget is. But in the letter, it says that there are some Bureau review recommendations that have not been fully implemented. What are those recommendations that haven't been implemented?
I think on the first point, it was only highlighting that specific area because obviously we furnished the committee and all of that information is published in relation to our overall budget. But of course, in relation to the Bureau review recommendations that haven't been implemented, it's really about ensuring that we had that further discussion with the UK government about what future allocations would look like. So in spite of us having raised that repeatedly over the course of the past few years and since the Bureau review, those discussions have never taken place.
But that's the overall budget. But you actually state that the committee would be aware that the Bureau Review recommendations had not been fully implemented. I am not aware. I'm asking you what those recommendations are that haven't been implemented.
Again, it's the discussions on the future allocations. It was a specific recommendation that should take place, because I think the sort of interim situation that we have was never meant to be a full-time solution.
Okay. The other thing that raises questions is, and if you just bear with me, I'm just going to find it again. It's in relation to ring-fenced funding. The table suggests that there's ring-fence money and there's Bureau Review money, and they're completely separate. So the Bureau Review money is not ring-fenced. It's not a payment which is conditional, a payment from the UK Treasury, which is to be used for agriculture. It's not ring-fenced in that way.
It is. I mean, what we provided there is a quote from the letter from the UK government, from the Treasury in 2021, where they ring-fenced certain sums. There are other areas, for instance, in marine, that are ring-fenced too. So they require us to take the example there in the current financial year. The main ring fence, if you like, is the £595 million, and the Treasury require that is used for the purpose of supporting farmers, land managers, rural communities and rural businesses. They then separately identify a sum that is labelled as BEW of £25.7 million for farmers and land managers, building on the BEW recommendations. So we then look and we report to Treasury to demonstrate that we are meeting those commitments. So you see that the requirements from Treasury for those two sums are slightly different but overlapping. So the exam question from Treasury for us at the end of each year is, have you spent at least that amount of money on these areas? And the answer to that is yes. How we are spending the money is then set out in detail in the budget documentation that's published by the Scottish Government.
Okay, it's still a bit confusing, because ultimately the Bureau Review was a process that went through to address or to identify whether the ring fence money was appropriate. It reflected the nature of agriculture in Scotland, and it suggested that it didn't, and we had an uplift of £25.7 million per year after that review. So ultimately, what we're looking at is the ring fence money wasn't adequate due to the review. It's been increased by £27.7 million, or very loosely, in general. What my difficulty is that, in the letter it also says, savings totalling £61.1 million were giving up from within the ring-fenced budget. Now, it's either ring-fenced or it's not ring-fenced. This is the difficulty, because the 61.1 doesn't relate to the 25.7 million. So, when is the Scottish Government allowed to dip into the ring-fenced budget, which is allocated from the UK Treasury for agriculture?
I think there's a few points just to clarify there. I think in relation to the budget that's set out there, and the Bureau Review as a whole, so the initial recommendations of that were never meant to be a long-term solution. Now, in that first year of savings that you'll see set out there, I mean, all of that is the ring-fence funding. Now, the first allocation of the Bureau Review, which is highlighted as a specific budget line in that financial year's budget, we only got confirmation that was coming too late in the year for it to actually be spent, which is why that then had to be offered up as a saving and why that's specifically highlighted within that table. But what we've also tried to set out within that letter as well is that the Bureau line wasn't then separated out in other financial years, because it just became part of the baseline that we received from
the
UK
government.
Absolutely,
the point I was making. Yep.
Yes, Though, again, what we've highlighted, though, in one of the first tables is the overall quantum that makes within the ring fence that we received from the UK government. Sorry, I don't know if there's more that you want to add, George.
I think as well, we just need to be clear. BEW was not about reviewing ring fencing. Mm-hmm. BEW was because in the CAP 2014 to 2020, the convergence element of that, Scotland, the UK qualified for money only on the basis of Scotland's lower per hectare rate. the basis of the Bureau review was that then that was not being properly passed on to Scotland. That was accepted by Lord Bew in his report. The UK government then did the right thing and made the payments that Lord Bew had recommended, and those came in the previous financial year, so earlier than the period we're looking at, and that money was added to the payments out to the farming community. That then left the question of future years. As the Cabinet Secretary said, there was in late 2019 the agreement for the further 25.7 million to come through. Ring fencing is a later concept. That is about the replacement of what would have previously been European money, and is there largely to demonstrate that we are still getting the money that we would have had we still been.
But it's ultimately all ring fenced, because it's not like any other part of the Scottish settlement, which is subject to the Barnett formula. So all the funding that comes to agriculture in Scotland is not subject to Barnett. So in effect, it is ring-fenced for agriculture. Is that not the case?
The sums that are ring-fenced are those as set out in the letter. That is what Treasury requires of us, that £595 million goes for farmers, land managers, rural communities and rural businesses, and the 25.7 for farmers and land managers following Bew. That is what we are required to do. And that is what we do. So even with the savings that have been made, we are still spending more than is required by the ring fencing requirements on these areas. But we also have the commitment repeated from the Cabinet Secretary for Finance that those sums will be returned to the portfolio.
I get that, but the letter doesn't suggest that, because it says the total 61.1 million were given up from within this ring fence budget, which doesn't suggest that any of the savings came from the top up funding from the Scottish Government. I think we need to look into this a little bit deeper. I think maybe this is not the time to do it given the time constraints, but I think the committee will maybe have some further questions we want to ask surrounding that. There is one question, I think, before we move on from this specific line of questioning, is about what your position is on future discussions with the UK Government on funding going forward. What is your position? What is your ask of the UK Government in these discussions and negotiations?
First of all, I would just want to say that... If the committee have more follow-up questions to clarify this, I'm more than happy to try and address that. But any savings that were offered that had been outlined in the two emergency spending reviews that we've had were from the ring-fenced element of the budget, which is why they then have to be returned to the portfolio, of which we had the £15 million returned this year. And of course, the remainder, £46 million, is still subject to those discussions on future budget allocation and discussions I'll have with the Cabinet Secretary for Finance. In relation to what future allocations, again, this is a point that we've tried to address for a number of years. With the UK Government, we'd had a meeting of the interministerial group, the first one in about a year, with our Welsh and Northern Irish counterparts, where we had some initial discussions on this. Again, we're seeing this as an important opportunity to reset the relationship that we have with the UK Government when it comes to future allocations. Now, of course, I know that there's various asks about what the overall funding settlement should be to the Scottish Government, and of course I'm not going to get into any detail of negotiations that I'd be hoping to have with the UK Government, but I mean, what we've asked for right along, I think what we've been promised at the very start when we left the EU is that we would see full replacement of funds. We haven't seen that. We need to see multi-year allocations, which allows us to plan much in the same way as we were able to do under CAP previously. So I think there are some basic points of principle there that we would like to see delivered.
It certainly would be helpful for the committee if we understood the general direction of travel, whether you were looking for a settlement based on your rural development plans, your future plans for delivering support for rural areas, or whether it's going to be formula-based, like, I hesitate to suggest it might be like the funding formally we have for the rest of the Scottish budget. But it would be good to understand exactly what the situation is, whether you're looking for the Scottish Government's ambitions to be funded or whether there'll be some sort of formula in place for future year funding.
I mean, that's the thing. Of course, we want our ambitions to be funded, and we think we can deliver so much more, I think, when you look in relation to our ability, what we need to deliver for agriculture and agricultural transformation, supporting food production, lowering our emissions, enhancing nature and biodiversity, the capabilities that we have for peatland restoration, for forestry as well, that not only help our targets and the emissions targets that we need to meet in Scotland, but also help the UK more broadly, that I think that we should and quite rightly expect a higher proportion of budget in relation to those areas as well. So I think that would be critical going forward.
Thank you. I think Rachel Hamilton's still got a brief.
Yeah, and for the follow-up on that letter, you did argue yourself that the BEW funding was part of the overall agricultural spend funding. And then that meant it was brought in line with the budget, and then that applied to the ring-fenced funding. So, I mean, I know we've been through this multiple times in terms of that £61 million being part of a saving, but you also said that you are spending more. And can you give the committee... Do you mean on the totals, the 609, the 620, the 627, the 627 over the years? Is that what you mean?
I think I just want to be... I mean, the overall quantum that we receive in the ring fence isn't the only spending that we make in the rural economy. I mean, you can see that from the published budget. So the budget for the portfolio is about £1.1 billion around that area. So, of course, the figures that we have there, the £620 million, is a ring-fenced element of that. But, of course, we have other funding above and beyond that the ring fence, which is all for the rural economy and for the other priorities across the portfolio.
Okay, so just to be clear, the 620.7, does that remove the £61 million that was made in savings?
Sorry?
The £61 million that was removed in savings. In the 23-24 line.
Right, so if you're to look over the course of the past few years, so the overall budget that we had in 22-23 was £1.15 billion.
Yeah.
So the ring-fenced within the 22-23, I believe, was the 600 and...
20.
Oh, so it was £609 million within that. So there were an element of savings that were offered at that stage, which had come from, again, some of the unspent funds within that overall ring fence, and then it was the same the following year. Though, of course, the budget was slightly different. The overall quantum of budget that we had then was £1.17 billion. And the quantum of ring fence funding we had within that was £620 million.
I think... Perhaps it might be helpful that what we've provided in the letter is simply a small extract from the letter from the Treasury. I think perhaps the fuller letter that would provide that in context, well, I hope we will be able to share, because it's not like, to put it simply as I can, here is a cheque for £595 million, you can only spend it on that. Rather, the letter is setting out the entire funding for the Scottish Government, including the block grant determined through Barnett. And it is then, the letter then says, and within that you need to be spending at least this amount on these areas. So the Treasury is saying, their way of setting out the ring fences of this much bigger multi-billion pound budget, you must be spending this much in this area. So I understand it, it is confusing. We probably internally rate a much larger proportion of our expenditure as being of a ring-fenced nature, so the money that we're giving to farmers, land managers and others. And through doing that, we've had the commitment from the Finance Secretary that money will be returned to the portfolio. Unlike, I think we should be clear, any other savings in other portfolios that have been given up over the last 2 years. So we're the only ones that have this commitment that the savings are coming back into the portfolio.
I'm not going to go into other portfolios, no. Mr Burgess, to ask if they were ring-fenced.
Suggest that there are some questions left still to be answered, but just I'm very conscious of time, so we'll maybe discuss this in the committee and write for some more clarification. Thank you. We're now going to move on to the impact of budget cuts and service delivery. A question from Marianne Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I've got a number of questions in this area. So we heard from the Scottish Agricultural Organisation Society that cuts to the Agricultural Transformation Fund and Agricultural Reform Programme have reduced the scope of the government to provide either capital or resource funding to help the farming sector to prepare for change and or de-risk trialling new ventures and initiatives. And I'd be interested to hear from the Cabinet Secretary on whether you believe that is the case and what you're going to be doing in this upcoming budget round to actually encourage innovation rather than constrain it.
No, I appreciate that point, and to be honest, capital has been one of the biggest challenges that we've faced in the portfolio. I think we've seen an overall cut to the capital budget to the Scottish Government of about 10%, so of course that has had huge ramifications, and I think it's capital ideally we would like to have been in a better position than where we are, and I think the cuts to capital have also led us to the situation that we faced in forestry as well. Now, what I would say though in relation to some of the particular funds that you've touched on there, so the Agricultural Transformation Fund, obviously we'd seen a decrease in the published budget from what we had initially last year. There was a cut of £2 million to that budget. We have actually though ended up in a better position with the ATF fund than what we had initially anticipated. So we had been prioritising that fund. Obviously we have the water environment regulations that are coming into place. We had therefore focused that fund largely on helping to support slurry stores and irrigation lagoons. We had when we'd opened that for funding this year, we were hugely oversubscribed for that. I think that we received applications in the region of about £7 million. But we have fortunately been able to fund all of the applications through that. That has come about as underspends in some areas that we've then been able to use to ultimately fund that. So I think as much as it looked like a cut this year from last year, which it was, we have been able to supplement that and fund all the applications as well. And I would highlight the other funds that are really important for all those things that you've talked about. AICS as well is another one where we've had a record approval rate for the applications that came through from 2023, and we've been able to fund all of those within that as well. So I think in some areas, what has been a cut, we've actually been able to utilise some underspend or monies from elsewhere to fund all of that as well. But again, I don't know what the overall quantum for the budget is going to be next year. So of course, that is quite a significant concern that we've got. I think particularly if we are set to see further cuts to capital budgets, because again, that's where these funds are hugely important for enabling all the work that we want to see, again, you know, supporting food production, but also ensuring that we're helping farmers and crofters do what they can to lower emissions and enhance nature and biodiversity too.
But so, I mean, that's great to hear that there's been such tremendous uptake of the Agricultural Transformation Fund, for example. And I hear your point about being able to move funding from one budget line to another in order to cover that. And I also hear your point about not really knowing what your quantum is. But will you take the enthusiasm from people who are applying, from farmers, land managers who are applying for this, and put that into your thinking for the upcoming budgets?
Oh, yes, of course. I mean, I think, and that's where we've tried to prioritise schemes like that at all costs, because we recognise how important that is. And I think, especially when we're in this period of transformation, we want to be able to support farmers and crofters as best we can with that. So, of course, I do take all those comments on board.
Thanks. So something else that's been raised to our brought to our attention is around the detail in the budget lines, and that there's not enough detail to allow for robust analysis. So, for example, RSPB Scotland has stated that due to a lack of transparency, it's difficult to judge what cuts to the Agricultural Transformation Fund and the Agricultural Reform Programme will realistically mean, as there's simply not enough information on what exactly such budget lines are spent on. And this is important information for external stakeholders who are looking for detail on what spending changes in these areas could mean for activities such as soil testing, slurry storage, as you've talked about, and carbon audits. Could you consider, could we bring about a point where actually we can actually get a bit more detail? I think it's level four. We need a bit more detail that's publicly facing and user-friendly people.
I appreciate that. And I think we do look to provide that information. I mean, I think using ATF as an example, that has its own specific budget line there as well. And I would like to think that, you know, we are transparent in that. And obviously, when we open it up, we're setting out what that fund is going to be able to be used for. But I think I'm more than happy to look into these particular concerns if there's any other information that we can look to provide. But we do try and be as transparent with that as possible.
Yeah, I think the point is just, can we get a more detailed breakdown on line items in the budget so that people can easily see where things are going and then raise questions and concerns? Because as you can understand, a lot of people have got their eyes on the budget this year and ongoing because of the transition that we have to be making.
Absolutely. Sorry, George, was there anything you want to add?
I think simply to say, I mean, I think the overall main budget documentation, I think the format of that and the level of detail is agreed with your colleagues on the Finance Committee. However, we do provide for this committee, and I believe it is published as well, the level four breakdown that gives us rather more detail. Of course, even within some of the smaller budget lines, there's then further granularity. So, you know, even taking it down to level four might not give the level of detail. For instance, you mentioned SAOS, a very good organisation, really helping across the supply chain and join up. The funding that we provide for that is actually, I think, buried in our food and drink line.
Yes, indeed. So that's the thing. How do we unbury that? How do we unearth that, surface it, and make sure that information is really clear for people?
I absolutely appreciate the point, but I think that's one that we can take away and see again, because that's discussions I think we would have to have with other colleagues to see the level of information that we can provide there.
Okay.
But I understand the point that you're making.
Great, thanks. And then finally, probably a tiny little blip on one of the buried budget lines on the Good Food Plan. So stakeholders have raised concerns about the slow pace and opaque nature of the Good Food Nation Plan development process, and I'm hearing how frustrated they are. The consultation closed 5 months ago on the 22nd of April, and the analysis apparently is still not yet being published. Stakeholders feel it's disappointing that the government is taking more than 3 years to produce a plan, especially one which, again, they feel is unfortunately unambitious. How can the government ensure that there's sufficient budget allocation to take this work forward at a faster pace? And could you give us clarity today on the timetable?
I set out to the committee, which I hope was helpful, a couple of weeks ago, I think some of the timescales that we're working to in relation to that. Now, obviously, I hear those comments that you've said about what people feel about the initial draft of the plan. Obviously, that was the initial draft we went out to consult on. So the feedback, we will, of course, give that careful consideration as we're developing that. But I think it is, I know that we haven't published the results of that consultation yet, but I would say that we did have really strong response to the consultation, and I think through the scrutiny of the bill what came through all of that was just the level of engagement that we were required to undertake, and of course it's within our best interest to undertake too. That included a lot of engagement with children and young people as well, where we generated a significant response. So I would just ask for a little bit of patience in that regard, because obviously it is taking time to work through those responses to then develop or look at what potential changes might be needed to be made to the plan before it then comes back to Parliament for scrutiny as well. So I obviously want to make sure that the plan is in as strong as a position it can be, recognising that this is going to be the first iteration. We don't have all the information, we don't have all the data that we need. Of course, that will improve with further iterations of the plan as well. But of course, we are committed to bringing that work forward. But again, I think we just need the time to work through all the considerable number of responses that we receive before we bring back that plan.
And can you assure...
Can I stop? That's not... This is... We're straying off budget. These were questions that were posed at a previous session. So
reassured that there was line item in the budget for that.
That should have been your first question.
Yeah.
If you wish to address the question on the budget,
I did ask. Was in my question.
Very briefly, then, the analysis of the consultation has been prepared for publication and will be published soon.
Thank you. Christine Graham.
Yes, mine, I hope, is about the budget and will be brief. I'm sure you'll stop me, convener. right. I didn't know much about you to this, but SEOS has said, quote, food processing, marketing and cooperation scheme funding was withdrawn, which has starved the farming and food sector from access to capital funding to allow it to invest in increasing productivity, improving supply chain cooperation and adding value to primary produce. Now, my understanding is that that capital funding was pump priming to allow other money to be levered in. How much was that was withdrawn? And was that, I know you've got to make choices, Minister, Cabinet Secretary, but was it a good choice?
Well, that's the thing. I mean, ideally, we haven't run, just as outlined in response to earlier questions, we haven't had an FPMC scheme for the past...
Yeah, you'll need to...
Food Processing, Marketing and Cooperation
Grant. Right.
We haven't been able to run that programme for the past 2 years, and that's because of the significant capital restraints that we find ourselves in. I think the last iteration of the scheme, I'm sure George will correct me if I'm wrong, I think we had about £10 million available for funding through that. I would have to look back through the detail to see the number of projects we've been able to fund through that scheme. Of course, it is really disappointing. I mean, I engage with food and drink businesses and I know the impact that not having this funding has had. It means that some aren't able to make the investment that they would like to. I've also visited businesses who've had FPMC funding previously and the very positive impact it's then had on their business. So ideally, it's not where we want to be. And if we are able to reintroduce that, whether that's in next year's budgets or whenever we get the opportunity, we will, of course, look to do that. And we would be pretty much ready to get up and running with that. We'd utilise that time in the scheme not running to have a review of it to see whether the scheme could be improved in any way, getting that feedback from people who'd applied through it previously. So we've taken on board and built in those recommendations, but again, it's just a lack of capital funding at the moment that means we're not able to fund that.
Supplementary, was that £10 million the annual figure?
Yes.
And the other part is, you said it had a positive impact. Can that be quantified?
Yes.
And that would
be
useful to write to the committee with that.
Absolutely, yeah. I'd be happy to send further information.
Thank you.
I know from visits that I've been on to various processing facilities that it has had a positive impact. It's helped lead leveraging funding for equipment, machinery, which has all helped with business efficiency on the whole as well.
Yeah, but when I say positive impact, I mean cash, money, funding coming in. I hope that was short.
Thank you very much. I just want to make members aware we are very, very, very short in time. It's such a huge portfolio and understand that we could take evidence for quite some time. So could I ask members to try and keep their questions as brief as possible, and which is not easy, particularly when we cover forestry and woodland. But on that note, can I bring in Ariane Burgess, please?
Mr. Convener, we've been hearing from a number of stakeholders around concerns around the Forestry Grant Scheme, and we heard from the Woodland Trust that they've outlined that there must be sufficient funding for forestry, peatland restoration, the Nature Restoration Fund, agricultural environment schemes and the relevant agencies, including those focused on skills development. And it's my understanding that the recent 41% budgetary cut to the Forestry Grant Scheme is predicted to cause a significant fall in the amount of new woodland created in 24 to 25 compared to previous years, and it will be one of the biggest ever gaps between target and delivery. Also, it's undermining sectoral confidence. How is the Scottish Government proposing to respond to these views that cutting planting funding will reduce the possibility of the Scottish Government meeting its own annual targets?
You're absolutely right. I don't think there's any shying away from that. I've had engagement with CONFOR, with the Woodland Trust as well. I've heard these concerns directly. And ultimately, as I've said in this committee previously, this is absolutely not a situation that we want to be in, particularly at a time when we had seen record approvals. I mean, Over the course of the last year, we planted around 15,000 hectares. Over half of that have been native planting as well. The budget cuts that we've seen to the capital budget for this year mean that we're only, well, we would hope to see in the region of about 10,000 hectares of planting. So, of course, that does have, that is a huge impact, and it does mean that we're not able to meet the targets that we'd set out for this year as well. I also understand, and I completely take on board the points about industry confidence. Again, I've heard that from them directly. This isn't where I want to be. I want to ensure that there is that confidence there, and we maintain that trajectory that we had been on. But of course, as I've already outlined, it's just the capital funding picture that we face as a whole has been really devastating to some of these budgets. So I absolutely appreciate the points that have been made. It's not where we want to be. But yes, unfortunately, we won't be meeting the targets that we've got. And again, 10,000 hectares is what we would hope to achieve. But I would say within that, and I don't know if Brendan would want to add further detail about, we are trying to maximise what we can do within that funding as well. And I know that there's been some amazing initiatives that we've had, the Integrating Trees Network as well. It's looking at the smaller scale planting as well. That's been really important. Some of the other lines that you mentioned that they talked about there as well, in terms of AICs and other sources of funding, I recognise the importance of those. But I don't know if it would be helpful if Brendan set out some of the other work that we're doing just to maximise within the budget that we've got.
Yeah, I can do quickly. Yeah, we've taken a number of actions to try and mitigate the budget reduction. So, for example, we've allocated a proportion of our budget into a category where where applicants have to accept to take a reduced level of grant. Now, that doesn't work for all projects, often doesn't work for native projects, but it can work for projects that have a significant element of future timber income. So we're able to make the money go further. That's early days on that, but it did apply to about 2,000 hectares of the planting last year, and we think that might be the case for a similar area this year. And if that's why we've been tentative, and the cab section is tentative about the actual area we'll support, because it could be a bit higher, but it depends on how that initiative goes. We're also looking to forward commit, and that gives certainty to projects. So we have committed an element of planting into 25-26, and if should money become available or other projects become delayed, then we can shuffle the funding around and bring them forward, and that's quite helpful for mitigating the impact on nurseries, because obviously the planting season is a different, slightly different period from the financial year, and that flexibility is helpful. But we're definitely exploring everything we can to make best use of the money and mitigate the reduction.
Thank you.
I'm going to move on to questions and agricultural support from Emma Harper.
Convener, I am conscious of the time, but as the convener said, the portfolio was pretty wide and diverse. Looking at the regulatory impact assessment, there's the payments framework, food and drink, climate and nature, genetics, animal health, welfare, forestry, knowledge, skills, innovation, training. There's loads, right? So I'm going to focus though on the tier one through tier four framework, and I'd be interested to hear about, you know, we know how we have to balance food production and food security with biodiversity and environmental sustainability and all that. And we had evidence from SAOS about Tier 3 and Tier 4 not becoming the poor relation to Tier 1 and Tier 2. So can you give us some affirmation about the Tier 1 through 4 and that 3 and 4 are not going to be forgotten about?
No, you're absolutely right, and I wouldn't want it to think that that's necessarily the structure of it, like 1, 2, then 3, then 4. They're all interrelated, and of course I would agree with SAOS. We know that the tiers 3 and 4 are really important, you know, tier 3 for that wider collaboration support, and tier 4, which is that the agricultural knowledge and innovation system that we've been developing and looking to work on, the CPD that's available through that as well. So I would just want to emphasise we recognise how important those parts of the framework are, but of course we've set out where we think the overall proportion of the balance of the funding would be within the new tiers, but of course this is going to be phased in over time as well, which we've set out through the roadmap.
And tier 1 and tier 2 get the most of the funding, and then 3 and 4, how does it work?
Again, there's been calls for clarity within what the overall split within what would be tiers one and two would be, but we are still undertaking engagement with stakeholders in relation to that, so I'm not in a position to set that out at the moment. So what we have set out is what we'd announced earlier in the year, which is the overall that tiers one and two would make up 70% of what a future quantum of funding would be, with tiers three and four the remaining 30%.
So will we get some further detail as it's been prepared?
Yes, we'll be happy to keep the committee updated.
Okay, thanks. Thank you.
So just on that, so there's a commitment to 70% just now, but are you suggesting there might be a degree of modulation in the future which would see some of the 70% redistributed to pillars three and four, tiers three and four? Is that something that you're considering?
This is the starting point, so I'm not going to predict in the future, and I certainly haven't got in mind what any potential future, what that would, if it was to change, what that would change to, because I think what's really important is, first of all, we actually need to start to implement the new tiers of the framework and to see how all of that is operating.
But that might be part of your consideration.
Again, we're starting off with that is what the overall quantum of the funding would be, and it would certainly be that for the immediate future. That's what we've announced. So, again, I'm not anticipating making changes to that immediately.
In the next 5 years or...?
Again, we need to implement the new tiers of the framework. It's not possible for me to set that out.
OK. Emma.
Just come back with a wee supplementary there. You said that it's not really a hierarchy, tier 1, 2, 3 and 4. It's more a sphere, and some of tier 1 might cross over into other support mechanisms, like support and biodiversity and sustainability. So is that something that, it's not just, you can't just pigeonhole every tier, because there is a lot of cross-portfolio, work that would need to be taken out. And I see George Burgess nodding at that question, so I'm assuming that's what it means. It's just, you can't just pigeonhole each tier.
Yeah.
Absolutely, just to expand on my nod, we're not looking at, tier one is just, just a payment that you get for doing whatever, and then all the work on biodiversity, climate change is in tiers two and three. Actually, the conditions, so the requirements for the whole farm plan is about making sure that all of the money, we're moving people towards a direction where the way that they're managing land is beneficial.
And the likes of the Tier 4 would help supplement that work as well, because we would want it to be the case that if people are baselining the business and undertaking some of it, whether it's the soil test and the carbon audits, about getting the support to then work on that information. They very much complement each other, and like you say, it's not a hierarchy.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks.
Just to clarify, 70% will be a basic payment delivered in Tier 1 and 2. But that 70% will remain as a basic payment. There'll be none of that money transferred to three or four, but some of that basic payment will be determined or only drawn down when certain conditions are met. Mm-hmm. Just to make that clear. Thank you. We now move on to our final theme on the National Islands Plan. A question from Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, we've heard obviously about £20 million has been spent on the islands programme so far, but some islanders have pointed out lack of progress in meeting the objectives. So could you speak to the value for money so far and what the plans are to ensure that we're seeing results from what's been spent moving forward?
Absolutely right. I think one thing I would want to point out, first of all, is that we'd undertaken consultation last year on the National Islands Plan. We're working on a new plan which best meets islanders' objectives and what they want to see. And I think it's really important. That will be a really important piece of work. From that, though, obviously we have a number of strategic objectives within the current National Islands Plan. The Islands Programme is established to help deliver on some of those objectives. But what I would say is it's just a reminder that this portfolio on its own and the Islands budget on its own will never, and it's not intended to satisfy all those objectives, because obviously there's transport, there's housing, there's other investment that comes from other portfolios. But what I would say is, in relation to the Islands Programme itself, over the course of the past few years, it's delivered over £12 million of investment across 61 different projects, across 50 different islands. really trying to deliver on some of the objectives that we've set out there. I was visiting one of the projects just recently, actually, within the past few weeks. It's the new nursery that's getting built in Kirkwall, in Orkney as well, which had, I think, the biggest allocation that we've ever seen from the Islands programme. It's not quite completed yet, but it's on its way there. And I think it just really highlights, I think, some of the impact of that work and the impact of that funding too. I think what's also important within the budget this year too is that with the resource element of that funding, we recognise that there are immediate cost of living pressures that are particularly acute for people living on our islands and the increased cost of living that they face. So that's why we've really tried to utilise that funding by allocating that to local authorities to use it the best way that they see fit to help their communities. And then alongside that, there's the other project that we're working on, which is the carbon neutral islands as well, and the funding that we're providing for various projects through that as well. I think that's already delivered some really important projects across each of the different islands. We've got another fund running this year that's a competitive bid process as well. So we really hope that that will help deliver on the objectives that we've set out there. So on the whole, I think the Islands programme is a really important element of the wider pieces of work that are also happening across the government and how we deliver for our island communities.
Great, thank you. And do you think there's work still needing to be done on coordination on meeting those objectives by other departments?
I know that the Islands team do work really closely across other departments as well. Yeah. And from the point that they were established, I think it has been the case of really reaching out and ensuring that they are having that engagement. So I think that's always been a work in process as well. But I would like to think that they're fairly well known now.
Yeah, and I would absolutely agree with the comments around the progress on the carbon neutral islands. I've visited quite a few of the projects myself and seen the difference that they're making. Will the feedback that they're providing on the competitive bid process and other elements of the funding be taken into account as things move forward in future years?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I do think, and we've discussed at length at the committee previously in various iterations of the Islands programme, we've had direct allocation previously, we've run the competitive bid model. Of course, there's pros and cons to each of those models, but I would say that we genuinely have taken on board the feedback that we've heard from members of the committee as well as people who are utilising the fund as well. So I think that we've made changes and adapted the Islands programme funding as we've gone through it in response to some of that feedback. So of course, any feedback you're hearing or other committee members are hearing in relation to the Carbon Neutral Islands programme and how that's operating, I'm more than happy to take that on board and listen to that if there's any improvements to be made for future.
Great, thanks.
Thank you. Rhoda Grant.
Thanks. We're halfway through the financial year and the £3 million of Island Programme money has not been allocated yet. Why is that?
That is going to be imminent. I understand that the board, considering the projects, I think had met within the past couple of weeks to consider that, but the announcements are due imminently.
Okay. And why has it taken so long?
I think that's just the timing of the process that they've had. I mean, it's relatively late that we had confirmation that we had budget to present. Cabinet Secretary said within the last couple of weeks, I believe it was actually yesterday that the panel was meeting to consider. So you know, the team will be cracking on with the work.
Okay. Is that going to have an impact? Will the money be spent in time? Will communities, local authorities lose out?
Again, I hope and sincerely hope that we will be able to utilise that funding. But of course, I haven't heard the results of what the outcome of that process has been yet, what the projects are as well. But of course, I'll be very alive to that as an issue. But of course, I'll be hoping that we're able to see that funding fully utilised.
Okay, so if there is an issue, the government would look favourably into allowing more time for that spending to be carried out.
If it's possible for us to do that, but again, I want to make sure that the funding we've got is fully allocated and we're able to spend it. So we'll be fully aiming to do that.
Okay. And when will the announcement be made? When will
again, if the project board has just recently met, as George said, then that will be announced imminently. But of course, I haven't had that information yet, so I can't set out to the committee when that will be.
Days.
I haven't had any submissions in front of me, so it's just not possible for me to pull that out of the air. But again, it's imminently if those decisions have been taken. But again, I haven't had a submission on that, so I can't set that out.
Okay.
OK, Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and your supporting act. Very much appreciate the time this morning. It's been a long session. I will now suspend the meeting for approximately 10 minutes to allow a changeover of witnesses and a comfort break. Thank you. Welcome back. We will now move on to consideration of an affirmative SSI, the Plant Health Import Inspection Fee Scotland Amendment to No. 2 Regulations 2024. And I welcome to the meeting Jim Fairley, the Minister for Agriculture and Connectivity, and his officials. We have John Spears, the Senior Policy Advisor, SASA Policy and Pesticides Survey Unit, and David Corrigal, the solicitor. I invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for making time today to consider the draft SSI, the Plant Health Import Inspection Fee Scotland Amendment No. 2 Regulations 2024. As the committee will note, this is a very brief SSI which makes changes to two dates relating to plant health import inspection fees. It extends until July 1, 2025, the end date for easements regarding the introduction of fees in relation to official checks on medium-risk fruit and vegetables goods imported from the EU, Liechtenstein, Switzerland and Switzerland from being imported into Scotland. It is the same for fees in relation to plant health checks on goods arriving into Scotland from the EU, Liechtenstein and Switzerland via the West Coast ports. By way of context for these changes, I draw the committee's attention to the UK statutory instrument, the Official Controls Extension of Transitional Periods in Plant Health Frequency of Checks Miscellaneous Amendment Regulations 2024. And I wrote to you, Convener, on 29 August to seek the approval of the Scottish Parliament to proposals by the Scottish Ministers to consent to making of that UK secondary legislation affecting devolved areas. And I thank the committee in advance for its consideration of that. The SSI now before the committee represents consequential changes required due to proposals set out in that linked UK statutory instrument. The changes to the dates proposed on a GB-wide basis by the UKSI and the application of the related fees in Scotland through the SSI before the committee today are as follows. The UKSI makes changes to Annex 6 of the Official Controls Regulations by extending the period under which plants and plant products from the EU, Liechtenstein and Switzerland entering GB through a West Coast port are not subject to controls from the 31st of October 2024 to the 1st of July 2025. And that helps towards addressing the lack of clarity from the UK Government on the timeline for the implementation of checks on goods entering via West Coast ports, which the Cabinet Secretary and I discussed with the committee at its meeting on the 11th of September. We remain concerned, however, that the UK Government has yet to communicate clearly to the industry the timescales for the introduction of the range of checks at West Coast ports and at the complex issues that need to be resolved before that can happen. Similarly, the UKSI also extends the period during which certain EU medium-risk fruit and vegetables are not subject to certain import controls to the 1st of July 2025. A statement was issued to the industry by the UK Government on the 13th of September, setting out this extension of the easement of import checks on medium-risk fruit and veg imported from the EU from January 25 to July 1, 2025. Now, that clarity is welcome and it's long overdue. As I said at the committee on the 11th of September, we are trying to reset the relationship between the UK and devolved governments, and I hope that clarity on the dates provided through the linked SI represents a new beginning in that regard. And I would ask the committee to support this SSI to ensure that the relevant plant health import inspection fees for Scotland are aligned to those revised dates, and I therefore consider these regulations to be necessary and appropriate. And my officials and I would be happy to take any questions from the committee.
Thank you, Minister. Do any members have any questions? No.
Oh. Cross-party group on horticultural. I think that's correct, isn't it? I think
Yes.
Ms Hamilton and I, this was raised with us at a meeting that they had, concern about these charges. I think they very much welcome it.
Thank you. Now move on to agenda item 3, the formal consideration of the motion to approve the instrument. I invite the Minister to speak to and move motion S6M-14346.
Is that this one here? Is that the one here? Okay. I move that the draft SSI Plant Health Import Inspection Fee Scotland Amendment No. 2 Regulations 2024 be approved by this committee.
Thank you. Does any member wish to debate the motion? No. Is the committee content to recommend approval of the instrument? Yes. We are. And finally, is the committee content to delegate authority to me to sign off a report on the instrument? Yes. Thank you. That completes our consideration of the instrument. I will now pause very briefly to allow for a changeover in witnesses. We will now move on to agenda item 4, consideration of another affirmative SSI, the Rural Development Continuation of Operation Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations 2024. I note that the Scottish Government has also issued a correction slip for the explanatory note accompanying the instrument. And I welcome back to the meeting Jim Fairley, the Minister for Agriculture and Connectivity, and his officials from the Scottish Government. We have James Muldoon, the Head of Agriculture Support Policy Development Unit, and Lewis Kerr, the Solicitor. And invite the Minister to make some brief opening remarks.
Thank you, Convener. It's almost as though I never left. Thank you for considering the draft SSI, the Rural Development Continuation of Operation Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations 2024. The 2024 regulations use the powers of the Agriculture Retained EU Law and Data Scotland Act 2020 to enable the Scottish Rural Development Programme, or the SRDP, and rural support generally to continue to operate under assimilated law in the period from 2025 to 2030. This is required as the current rural development schemes would otherwise end in 2024. Our published agricultural reform roadmap sets out the timescale for a phased transition from legacy common agricultural policy, CAP schemes, into our new co-developed four-tier framework. Extending the SRDP will deliver this and ensure there are no cliff edges in support and a just transition. Existing reporting requirements are extended for a year to ensure there is no gap before the Agricultural and Rural Communities Scotland Act 2024 requirements are in force. The approach we have taken to this extension is consistent with the previous use of the 2020 Act powers to extend the SRDP.
Thank you. Any questions? Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Convener. Morning.
Good morning.
Mr. Fairley. Did the Scottish Government consult on this instrument? And if not, why not?
No, we did not. We didn't consult on this. It's part of the... Do you answer the full question?
So the consultation, the co-development that is going on through the Ag Reform Programme in terms of the route map and that phase transition, we sit around the table with the ARIOB as one example of that, with NFUS and multiple other partners. So this is part of that ongoing work to keep the present system, the present machine on whilst that transition happens, and all partners have been involved in discussions to flesh out that route map and what happens there in it.
Yes, but this committee doesn't have access to what's been said and fed back in the ARIOB, and so we have no idea about what the feedback is in terms of that code development, which sort of leaves it to a wing and a prayer, really, for us to scrutinise this particular SSI. I can't see how the co-design argument can be used in this case, because it seems as though the Scottish Government are relying on the previous consultation. So my question is to Jim Fairley, have you read the previous consultation?
This SSI does not change policy. All this SSI is trying to do is to allow us to continue to make payments beyond the current period to 2030. There is nothing hidden in it. There is nothing that is... that has not been considered by the full industry. This is just to allow us, as James has said, to keep the machine running to in order to allow us to continue to make the payments up until 2030.
I understand that, and avoiding cliff edges is incredibly important. But have you read the previous consultation responses?
No, I have not, no.
Okay, so we're being asked to scrutinise this SSI using the previous consultation responses, but I would ask, does Jim Fairley, having not read the previous consultation, still trust the evidence that these consultations
I absolutely trust the process that the government has gone through in complete collaboration with the industry, including NFUS, who are more than happy with this SSI to be passed. Because what this does is allow the government to continue to make payments. I genuinely don't understand where the concern is, because what this is doing is allow us to keep the machine on, to continue to make payments as we go through this transitional period. Otherwise, it stops at the end of this year and we just have a dead end. which is what nobody wants. And I'm quite sure that nobody in this committee wants either.
Well, why have you left it to the last minute?
Why have we left what to the last minute?
The bringing forward this SSI, if you had no consultation process.
It's not been left to the last minute. What we have done is we brought it forward at the appropriate time.
Well, there is a deadline, and you know we haven't been able to scrutinise the effect of this particular SSI. So in the past, and we have no idea what NFUS have said about this particular SSI, but there has been concern around rebasing the LFS, the LFAS, I'll call it LFAS, if you don't mind, less favoured area support.
Oh, that was so patronising.
But well, you did ask in the last acronym. Sorry about that, Christine. I was just being clear. So there hasn't been a consultation which would have allowed stakeholders to, you know, you're leaving it to secondary legislation so far. You're leaving it to the feedback you get in AREOB, which we are not party to. It is important that other people beyond NFUS are able to have a say in how the government deliver 65 million. We also don't know, you know, what the future, if the future payment will continue, 65.5 million in the next budget, in the 25-26 budget. We don't know that. We don't also know whether beyond 2030. There needs to be some consideration about whether the Scottish Government will continue with LFAS payments, because it's you know, the EU have discontinued LFAS payments. They've moved on to something entirely different. And it is the policy of the SNP Government to align themselves with Europe. So, you know, this committee would have liked to have known, you know, what the future holds, because it isn't long until 2030. You're just asking us to ensure that this payment continues. But how are we to know what, in general, farmers think about the current payment for active farmers, as it were? Because in the actual LFAS active farming rule, it says you would usually own stock. But we know that the stock is contracting across Scotland. We know that livestock is contracting, and that is a concern, and there are young people who want to get into farming, and there is a concern that those who are not necessarily actively farming livestock are able to access LFAS, and it is those young people who are coming through the system that should be supported to enable them to ensure that we do have a successful and prosperous future for farming in Scotland.
Okay. And your point is?
I'm sorry, Minister, but that is incredibly rude.
I don't think it's rude at all.
I have just made my point to you very specifically, and Minister, please, could I remind you
about the necessity to treat each other with respect. So can Absolutely. We have one person speaking at a time, please?
I'm still not sure of what the point of the question is, because this SSI merely allows the government to continue to make payments up until 2030. The committee is well aware that the route map is there. They're well aware that the LFAS arrangements are being discussed with AREOB. The committee, as far as I know, are well aware that the NFU have already cleared, as far as they're concerned, that this SSI is they're comfortable with it. We know that the LFAS is being reviewed and what that's going to look like, but this simply allows the government to continue to make the payments in whatever form they happen to be. And there will be far more opportunity for the government to, or for the Parliament and this committee, to review what it is that is going to be proposed as we go forward. This is purely the mechanism to allow us to continue to make payments in whatever shape or form those payments come forward as we go on from here. If we don't, it stops at the end of the year. So therefore, we want to make sure that there's a mechanism to continue to pay farmers. It's that simple. So I don't understand what it is that I'm being asked to do at this point.
Convener, from that, I just have taken away that the Scottish Government are recycling their old homework instead of conducting fresh research to inform this SSI to continue payments. I'll leave it there.
Thank you. I've got a list of members who want to come in. So I've registered all your interests. So I'm going to go to Ariane Burgess initially.
Thanks, Convener. And good afternoon, Minister. Thanks for joining us. The policy note states that, and so I'm just trying to clear something up around reporting. So the policy note states that there will only be a requirement for an annual implementation report for the old SR Scottish Rural Development Programme schemes in 2025, and thereafter any reporting will be wrapped up in the Rural Support Plan provisions set in the Act. And my understanding is that we won't have a rural support plan until autumn winter 2025, and then the reporting requirements on that are going to happen at the end of each plan period, so in 5 years. So that means not at least until 2030. So does that mean that there's no requirement for reporting on any schemes such as LFAS or AICS that would continue in the interim? And if so, why isn't there, and shouldn't there be ongoing reporting?
There will be ongoing. This particular reporting year is being rolled into the 2024 Act, so as that comes in to effect, there will be further reporting on that. But I'm going to let James clarify the detail of that because he's got far more understanding of it.
Thanks.
So the monitoring and evaluation programme that I believe we spoke about at previous committee sessions that is going to be required to be published through the Rural Support Plan of the 24 Act is a better vehicle for saying what the impact of the schemes are towards domestic outcomes, whereas this model of reporting fits only to the EU CAP outcomes as they were set in the last CAP period. And I think we discussed in previous sessions how the monitoring and evaluation from the Rural Support Plan reports on the schemes as is, I'll use the term schemes, but the support mechanisms as is appropriate to the support mechanisms. So we spoke on how some support mechanisms might have, well, naturally our budgeting will be reported on an annual basis, but some scheme outcomes might be on an annual or a 2 year or a 3 year basis, depending on what it is they're doing. So the purpose of only extending the reporting requirements through these powers for 1 year mm-hmm. is to allow it to be subsumed into that more appropriate monitoring and evaluation programme, which naturally will be very public in terms of making sure that we're sharing the information, because we very much need to learn that we are spending public money as efficiently and as effectively as we possibly can. So we certainly want to know how that money is going.
Okay, thanks for that. So, but the reporting is connected to the Rural Support Plan, and we're not going to get that until the autumn, winter 2025, but then reporting requirement on that is to happen at the end of each plan, which is a five-year basis. So are we not going to... Does that mean that we'll have all these schemes and we won't see reporting on a regular basis?
No, not at all, Ms. Burgess. The reporting is something we will be doing, as I said, per different support mechanism. And it might make sense at the end of a five-year plan period to do a more fulsome report of that. But different support mechanisms, we want to know the impact, we want to know the effectiveness of that. So it will be support mechanism by support mechanism on as regular basis as is appropriate to understand the impact thereof.
Okay, thanks very much. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Just to pick up on a couple of things within the our papers in front of us, it says that the policy note states that the extension of SRDP would allow for a phased transition away from SRDP over the coming years as post-Brexit Scottish agricultural policy comes into effect. And you've said, Minister, that this will take us up to 2030. And I'm thinking about the comments that Rachel Hamilton has made about active farmers, including attracting young farmers and new entrants and supporting them in our less favoured areas, including in southwest Scotland, right, in my part. So I'm interested in the resources that are currently working on the future policy right now, that you've got government resources actively planning right now. But does this mean that the policy will only remain like this up till 2030, or is there an opportunity for an alteration in the proposals that would allow rebasing, retargeting support in another way that would continue to support active farmers especially new entrant farmers.
In terms of how the policy will change, that will develop as we go along. But this SSI is purely to give the mechanism to continue whatever those payments look like. So whatever the scheme is, and I'm not going to say anything in case that gets put on the record and that then go and become the scheme, whatever that scheme looks like, we're absolutely committed to making sure we can continue to support the LFAS, but I say that on the basis of not the programme, purely the principle behind it. So whatever it looks like, this SSI allows us to continue to make the payments. And that's both yourself and Rachel Hamilton both mentioned new entrants. I think I've said to this committee before, I'm absolutely committed to making sure that we can do as much as we can to get new entrants into farming. It's something that I was desperately trying to do myself. I know the barriers that are there to it. So one of the things that is in the programme for government is asking public authority bodies who have got public land to look at how they can then allow new entrants to get onto public land. Now, this is purely the start of that, and what that's going to look like, I don't know, but we're at the early stages of saying how are we going to get young folk or new entrants into the industry and how are we going to support that as we go forward.
So this SSI is about stability and certainty ongoing up till 2030, while other programmes are being developed?
Yes, it is purely the mechanism to allow us to continue to make the payments. Whatever the programme looks like, it will develop as we go along.
Okay, thanks.
Just before we go any further, I think we need to put this discussion into context. So the DPLR committee has suggested that under Regulation 2, brackets 4, the instrument keeps the rate of payment under the LFAS scheme at the current rate, which is the rate that was applied in 2018 until 2030. Is that the case or not the case, Minister?
I hand over to James to answer that question.
The LFAS payment rate was previously set in regulation, and the model advised by our lawyers on this was simply to keep that as is. We have to be aware, we have to advise ministers, of course, if budgetary arrangements change and we still have that uncertainty of what's coming from the UK government, then further advice and further changes might be required to that rate if budgets do not allow for it.
So just to get it on record, and there's a question to you, Minister. Do you agree with the DPLR committee that this instrument does keep the current rate of payments the same as the rates applied in 2018? Is that your understanding?
My understanding of it, that is where we are at the moment. But as James said, that will be very much determined by...
But that's what we're deciding today?
Yeah.
Thank you. I've got Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. I want to dig into that a little bit more, because looking at the SSI and looking at the regulations, this does in effect just freeze the way that everything operates at the moment. So is the Minister saying that he's open between the introduction of this SSI and 2030 to making changes to the scheme? Because we've heard the arguments around rebasing and around encouraging new entrants. Further regulations could be brought to this committee.
Are highly likely to be brought to this committee as the scheme develops.
Okay, and what are the timescales in terms of consultation and opportunity for us to scrutinise such changes?
It will be under the regular process of how that would happen. We have an area of meeting tomorrow. There will be more discussions around what this is going to look like, what LFA payments may look like, and as that gets developed, we will then go through the normal process and those regulations will be brought back to this committee.
It does just feel as though we're taking a lot on faith if we're agreeing right now to freezing things up until 2030, when currently the LFAS is already based on historic data. So we have, I think, all of us been contacted by people who are concerned about that. And while I appreciate avoiding a cliff edge, I think a bit more clarity on what the options on the table are and how we can influence and scrutinise how things will look moving forward.
Okay. We can write to the committee with further details as we go along, if that would help.
would it be possible to have a bit more information and consider this SSI at a future meeting instead?
I think we need to get this done, don't we? No, we kind of need to get this done.
It's a decision for the committee, not the minister. But thank you for putting that on record.
Yes, sorry, I mean in terms of the cliff edge and decisions needing to be made by a certain point. If the committee wants a bit more information, will it cause an issue in terms of payments?
I'll let James clarify that point.
Ms. Farnock, I'll just come on that. So hopefully not to reiterate too much of what the minister said. The SSI today is about keeping the LFAS machine, so to speak, as it is, paying money on this basis. What we're looking to do in terms of future least favoured area support or area of natural constraint support was committed at the NFES conference last year by former First Minister, which is the future model of support for that will be housed in Tier 2 of the future support framework. So work is ongoing with partners. And it's a public commitment from Scottish ministers that there will be a support that allows for active farmers to be supported in their activities in areas of natural constraint. Mm-hmm. How we work that out is part of our commitment to the co-development and working with partners to develop what that will be. But this today is purely about keeping that existing mechanism going whilst that co-development work, which will be enacted subject to all being happy, of course, through the use of the 2024 Agricultural Rural Communities Act as we transition to support mechanisms on that.
Okay, I think there's probably not more I can say than my previous question in terms of us needing to be able to scrutinise what's going on and what the options are. So is there something from the government's point of view that means this SSI requires a decision today?
Yes, this SSI needs to be is required to keep the payment machine going just now. The future LFA model, ANC model, will of course be secondary legislation that would come to this committee.
I think we need to be completely certain about it. I think the question from Ms. Roddick there was, does it need to be decided today? Can you answer that question?
Well, it depends upon parliamentary time thereafter.
Well, but that's incredibly important. But I can tell you it doesn't need to be decided today. There is flexibility. It's not a cliff edge today if it's not decided. Beg pardon, Emma, would you like to come back in? Or?
I think I've asked everything I can.
Christine Graham.
Yeah, I mean, I'm learning as I go along here, and I think one of the key things, one, is understand this is interim, keeping policies as they were, bloody, bloody buzz. But it does say, under Regulation 2.4, which the convener has said, the instrument keeps the rate of payments under the less favoured area support scheme at the current rate that is the rate in 2018. So the next 12 years, according to this, the payments will stay at that rate on this instrument. That's the first thing. The second thing is, as they say, I'm new to this game. The interim doesn't usually mean to me 6 years to get something sorted out. Now, I understand it's a long-term thing in farming and so on, but 6 years for what is an interim measure, that's the thing. And I want clarity on what's being said around here, because it says at the current rate, which is rate applied until 2030, not up to, but there's a line in the sand at 2030. Are you saying to me, Minister, that it could be brought in, this interim measure could be earlier, could be finished in 2027 or something, or is it 2030? Is that the deadline? And
no,
that's the date that will be kept. So there's 3 points I want to make. The level of payments, the fact that it's 6 years away and it's called interim, and the fact that 2030 seems to be an actual date. It's not an up to or not later than, but 2030.
Okay, the quantum of the SRDP funding will stay the same. At this moment in time,
I know that.
The quantum will stay the same.
It's the level of funding. It's the level of funding.
So that's what I'm talking about. That level will stay the same as it currently stands.
For 12 years.
Yes, as it currently stands.
Minister, just in your previous response, you said that could change depending on the UK budget.
Well, that's exactly the position that we're in, convener.
So,
no, but this is law. This is the regulation. So, may I go on? This regulation will say, it will say at the current rate, 2018. That is legislation that says that.
Yes.
So you can't just... I don't think you can just then say, well, if we get more money, we'll not actually do that. We'll change the date, because this is now in black and white.
If the quantum has to change, then we'll have to change it. But we won't know that until we know what the certainty of of UK funding is that comes back to the Scottish Government.
So there'd be another regulation which says, well, it won't be the rate that applies in 2018, but the rate that applies in 2024.
It may well be that if that's what happens, but we don't know that until we have the certainty from the UK government.
I understand about budgets, I'm talking about legislation. If you put something in black and white, says the rate's going to be the rate of 2018, that's it. So you're going to apply that rate, so do you need another regulation that changes it? That's all I'm asking. I don't know.
But CAP sets the rates in legislation, so we're dealing with legacy of CAP. Which is why that was in legislation.
So, I just don't understand this.
Okay, I'll let James try and make it clearer.
Minister, if somebody says to me, Ms Graham, I'm going to pay you such and such at the 2018 amount, and that's going to be fixed for 12 years. That's the interim position. That's the position. But then you're telling the minister, you're saying to me, if you get more money, actually, I might pay more. They might get more than that. But that's not what the law says. The law says 2018 rates.
So I'll let James try and clarify it better than I've been able to do.
Sorry, so our CAP legacy systems, it's designed for a multi-year EU funding envelope, a funding window. We are applying year-to-year budgeting to this system now, and it's not designed for this. This means that our CAP payments, our CAP legacy payments, whether it be the basic payment scheme or LFAS that we're talking about in this instance, the rates are set in regulations so that the administrative schemes can then get the money out to farmers and crofters yes. eligible for it. So when it comes to LFAS, we are required to set in regulation what the payment rate will be.
2018.
Indeed. However, if budgeting realities change, and the quantum that we receive through the... Because we have to remember the agricultural budget is ring-fenced from UK, mm-hmm. so it's on a land basis instead of a population basis. If that quantum changes and requires advice to ministers that the money can't spread as presently is, then a further regulation would, of course, need to be entered to change that rate. But just now, for the administrative systems, we do have to set it in regulation to allow that to flow.
So I think I'm right. You'd have to have another regulation to change the rate. That's all I wanted to know. And the other one was 6 years. Why is it take 6 years?
It won't necessarily take 6 years. That's just to give us enough time. It's like a safety net, so that if we do have problems, then it's there. But again, that doesn't need to be set in stone. It's being laid today, but we can change that as we go along.
So at the current rate... until 2030 should probably read at the current rate, well, whatever that rate is, at the current rate, not beyond 2030 or something like that, because you're saying it could be earlier. So that made me think it's 2030, but no, it's not that. It could be earlier. Is that correct?
It could be earlier, yes.
So that's wrong to say, or am I being pernickety again, but saying until 2030 it should be, but not beyond 2030 or... whatever other language. Oh, a lawyer's coming in. I'm in trouble now.
Sorry, could you point me? Is this in the policy note, the specific text that you're referring to?
Yes, well, I've got it both in front of me. If you could read out the exact wording in the regulation that brings in, is it until 2030?
Sorry, I'm not entirely sure where you're pointing to.
I think it's the one from the DPLR committee report.
Yes, I'm reading.
I don't have that report to hand.
But see, that's all that concerns me, is the clarity. Is if you tell me it could be earlier, then perhaps we should have a different word before 2030. Not beyond or whatever, but not... I don't know. It just raises a concern for me.
I think the question is, why 2030? And if you're... assuming that there will be some changes to that rate, why not 2024, 25 or 26? Yeah. Why 2030 at the rates of 2018?
It's basically to give us time. I'm fairly sure we do not anticipate that this is going to go until 2030, but this is just to give us time so that we do not have to come back in 18 months' time or in 2 years' time to do this all again. It's just to give us some.
But that's not unusual. So in the first SSI that you dealt with, it looks to extend the time, but it's not to some time long in the future. It's a realistic time in where some issues can be resolved. You know, we see that regularly. And Minister, you'll be well aware of the number of times you dealt with SSIs, the extended border control legislation. But it wasn't years, it was a matter of months, a reasonable time for these things to be resolved. I think that's one of the concerns we certainly have. I'm going to bring back in Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. I'm just trying to seek assurances that how do you give farmers confidence that this SSI isn't going to, I suppose, fail to support the less favoured areas, new entrant farmers. How do we help convey that the interest that the government has is about continuity, stability, certainty, all these words that we're hearing because of the Brexit cliff edge that we've gone through. What's the best way to convey to farmers that this instrument is just to continue so that we don't have a cliff edge?
Well, all I can tell you is that as long as I'm minister, that my absolute commitment is to making sure that we can allow farmers to farm in these less favoured areas. I'm well aware of what that feels like and what it looks like. The purpose of this SSI is not to be duplicitous. It's not to try and hide anything. It is merely to give us the ability to be able to continue to pay in this particular programme up until 2030, but the likelihood is that that will change as the policy develops, and it will develop in conjunction with full consultation with the industry.
Okay.
It's all I can give you. I can't give you any more a guarantee than that, I don't think.
Okay.
Rachel Hamilton.
James, would you be able to run through what you said there about how this, or the Minister, can you run through how the future shape of LFAS or any replacement scheme will be shaped by stakeholders?
Okay, we will be at the AREOB meeting tomorrow. LFAS is on the agenda. We will be discussing what the early iterations of that look like. Is that on the agenda tomorrow?
I'm not sure if it is. I'll have to double check.
Right, okay. I think, I could be wrong in saying this, and I'll correct the record if that is the case, but I think we have some scrutiny of LFAS at the AREOB tomorrow, but it is in the ongoing programme of how we're going to develop the future LFAS, and I'm calling it LFAS purely so that we all understand what it is that we're talking about. The future LFAS payments, what they're going to look like and how they're going to be delivered over the coming years, because as I just made the point to Emma Harper, we're absolutely committed to making sure that the policy intent behind the LFAS is continued in terms of making sure we have stopping rural depopulation, making sure that we have active farmers working in these more disadvantaged areas, in order to make sure that that key element of our, I hate using the word remote, but these more remote areas are properly supported. That's the whole purpose behind it.
Okay, and may I ask where that feedback from the AREOB meeting, what mechanism will it be used through? So would it be used through the Rural Support Plan?
How do you mean
the feedback, will that then shape the Rural Support Plan?
It's part of the whole process of how we're actually going to develop the policy as we go forward. Okay. And I think the notes
but the agricultural bill is a framework bill.
Yep.
And that the SSIs are subject to the negative procedure. So are you planning to... this is subject to an affirmative procedure. So when the DPLR committee warned of the government using Henry VIII powers, this is going to be an example of that, isn't it?
No, I don't believe it is.
Can you explain why?
because the whole policy has been developed in conjunction with the industry sitting around the table. It's not just the NFUS, there are the Crofters Commission, there's everybody who's involved in the development of this policy is sitting around the table. And then as we bring regulations back, this committee will be able to scrutinise them.
But we're not able to scrutinise this in a wholesome and fulsome way right now, in my opinion, and we're being expected to make our decision on a wing and a prayer. So, unfortunately, yeah. I don't feel comfortable.
If I can clarify one point. So, as we've said, this is about the present LFAS mechanism. The future piece that you're speaking about, of course, there, you might recall the Cabinet Secretary brought forward the amendment at stage three in terms of the Rural Support Plan, where we took a duty upon Scottish ministers to put in the Rural Support Plan who we've spoken to, what their thoughts were for each support mechanism going forward. So the Rural Support Plan would, of course, have a full articulation of that policy development and rationale and who's been spoken to and what their views were within that, just to put that point.
And is that subject to a negative procedure, any sort of forthcoming
Lewis might correct me, but I'm fairly sure it was affirmative procedures for the first use of powers under the 24 Act.
I would have to go away and look at that, I'm afraid. I don't have that.
I mean, reporting on legacy cap schemes is a requirement of the Rural Support Plan, but that is a negative procedure.
But that's for future iterations.
Yes, but we are talking
rather
about
than
future.
This.
I mean, we're going around in circles here because this is up to 2030. So it's like the Rural Support Plan will be published in 2025, but we are now being expected to ask to be continuing this until 2030.
But it's not the... I don't know how else to put this. It's not the policy that develops out of the area that you're being asked to support today. All that you're being asked to support today is the mechanism to be able to allow those payments to happen as and when that development comes forward. So if we bring in a policy that the committee doesn't like at a later date, you will be able to say no, yes, whatever it is that you're going to do with it, whatever the committee decides to do with it. This is purely to allow the mechanism to allow the payments to happen. That's it.
Mr. Fairley, the SSIs that are coming forward for the future will be subject to the negative procedure.
That's not what today is.
I know, but you're trying to tie that in.
No, I'm not. I'm genuinely not.
Okay,
I'm trying to keep it very
no
focused on what it is that we're looking at right now.
No further questions.
Christine Graham would like to come back in and Rhoda Grant.
Understand it so there's certainty in the time being until you get to where you want to be now or not in the EU. But I've looked at the regulation here, and if I look at paragraph 2 of it, there's a list... section, for instance, scheme 2025 payment means the sum to which the applicant is entitled in respect of the period 1st January 2025 to 31st December 2025. Skipping the rest, I come right down to the scheme 2029 payment means the sum to which the applicant is entitled in respect of period 1st January 2029 to 31st December 2029, and then the same for scheme 2030 payment. So it's rigid, it's fixed in this regulation. These payments are there. This is management, as it were, of the payments. So you're going to get it at the 2018 rate right up to from the 1st of January 2029 to 1st of January 2030 to 31st of December 2030. It's fixed. It's not flexible. I'm just looking at, I don't understand it. I'm trying to understand the legality. This is important because this is one, the basis on which payments will be made and for which periods of time. And that can't be amended. If this goes through, that's that. What we'd have to come in, as I understand it, is another regulation. Am I right? I don't know. I'm asking.
Is that correct?
Yes, but if I can make the point again, this is... The reason these rates are set in regulations are because they're large administrative schemes. So it's to allow the
budget to flow. I don't understand the reasons, but they're fixed. This is fixed.
No, fixed until, as the Minister said, a replacement, a least favoured area, stroke area, natural constraint support scheme comes into play through the 2024 Act, and that will be articulated of its development in the rural support plan. This is simply to act as a backstop just now to keep this machine alive.
I really honestly understand that. So what you may be saying to me is that if things progress faster than you've got here, we've got this set up till December 2030, but if you develop this other method of payment sooner, you can just annul this, if you like.
Yes, the present scheme will no longer be relevant.
And you'll annul this piece of late. This regulation will no longer be relevant.
Yes, and the
that's all I wanted to know. I'm just trying to get my head around the law.
Rhoda Grant.
I think the real concern here is the time frame. So there are already concerns within the farming community about the length of time it's taking to bring forward a rural support plan and all the bits that are attached to this. So I guess the time frame you're putting into this regulation creates the fear that we could still be on 2018 funding for LFAS at 2030, because there's nothing this committee or the Parliament can do if we pass this to change it or to force government to change it, and it'll just go on. And that's not acceptable, I think, is what we're trying to say loud and clear. You can give us assurances, but you can't set in stone that that won't happen.
You're right. All I can do is give you the assurances that we are working incredibly hard right now to bring this framework, to bring the legislation forward that will allow us to continue to support agriculture in the way that we want to do. And if the 2030 date is the problem, okay, I take that point on board, but it's purely to allow us time to be able to get things done and get things moving in the right direction. But I'll reiterate to you, to the members, I did with Emma Harper, I'm absolutely committed to making sure that we bring policies forward and proposals forward that will work with and for the rural community, the agricultural community, to make sure that we can continue to support them as best we possibly can going forward. That's all I can give you.
I share the concerns of the committee that the 2030 date will retain the current rate of payments, which were set in 2018 up to 2030. And we just have to take it on, your good word, that there will be further SIs, which we as a committee or a parliament have no control over. So we could, unless the government is minded otherwise, to see the current rate of payments last until 2030 through another government, potentially, through multiple ministers. We are expected to put that into law today. Is there any reason why that date couldn't be 2025 or 2026? What is the reason for pushing out to 2030?
Well, you can. Yes. So the route map sets our timetable for that phase transition of when new schemes are looking through the 24 Act are looking to replace the present model that we have. The rationale for putting a longer date on this is very simply to avoid unnecessary use of time on this, because the core point about this is we're not changing the SRDP policies. We're not changing the outcomes that these are working towards.
Sorry, to prevent undue time on... I missed that.
Yeah, we...
To who?
Sorry, to all involved. To all involved on this.
Again, one of the biggest concerns we had over the new Agriculture Act was the lack of scrutiny, and we all accepted that a framework bill was the way forward to allow policy to be fleet of foot, be able to address issues that are coming up. One of the biggest concerns was that we would have the situation where there was a lack of ability for Parliament to scrutinise this type of thing. This is what I don't understand. Given that the desire of Parliament to be involved in this, why you would see potentially revisiting a policy like this in a year's time, or in 6 months' time, or 2 years' time, would be an issue. because that's exactly what Parliament wants to do. We want to scrutinise this. So pushing it today, we are expected to pass this regulation, which would allow the government to pay the current rate up till 2030. And I think that's, you know, that is very restrictive, and we would then rely on government bringing forward further central legislation to address that. So I just wanted to put, I think that's the, would appear to be the views of the committee at the moment. I just, there was one thing that is also important. What Minister, what's your current views on rebasing payments?
The rebasing argument is ongoing. I know that there are some members within the committee who have been approached about it, and there are members, there are farmers who wish it to be rebased. That's an ongoing conversation. I know the NFU at one point put it into the conversation at, I can't remember which committee it was, they'd written to the Cabinet Secretary to ask her to do rebasing. It was rejected at that point because we were looking at the whole structure of the policy programme going forward. I'm more than happy to look at every potential opportunity to make the best use of the funding that we currently have to make that work in the best way possible.
But,
goes
but
back
would
to
this,
the point I made at the start.
Would this piece of legislation mean that rebasing was off the table potentially until 2030?
No, it wouldn't, because any other legislation that comes forward after this, if rebasing was the desired position that we took, then that could be brought in at a later date, before 2030.
Any other comments from members? Emma Harper.
Just to clarify again, you said that there is potential flexibility in the issue around retargeting or choosing to support new entrants. You've already said that that's part of the potential future plan, so that this doesn't just pigeonhole the issue of rebasing as just kicked into the long grass.
Well, it would.
We will look at what all the opportunities are for to allow us to be able to pay the best way in the less favoured areas. That's still up for discussion.
Okay.
Emma Roddick.
Surely the fact that this SSI describes the 2030 payment means there's not really a rush to consider anything in the meantime, and it's not going to be a priority for government to change something if there is certainty up to 2030. And does that not just, as it's written, really risk nothing happening in the meantime?
No, the programme is ongoing. As I said, we are meeting, the IRIOB will be meeting again tomorrow. They meet on a regular basis in order to flesh out what it is that we're actually going to try to deliver. This SSI is purely about making the mechanism to be able to pay available. That's it.
Was there a discussion about how many years to include in this SSI, and why was this the number reached?
As James has already pointed out, the 2030 was to give plenty of flexibility so that we weren't taking up more time than was absolutely necessary. This bit of it is nothing more than a mechanism.
4 years is quite a bit of flexibility as well, isn't it?
Yeah.
So why six?
Well, as the convener's already asked, why not 26, why not 28? The number was picked at 2030. That's, you know, the relevance of it, I'm not really sure is going to enlighten us any.
So there weren't particular discussion points when choosing that date?
It was the date that was picked.
Thank you. I think we've had a widespread discussion. From the convener's perspective, and I think there's still quite a level of uncertainty over this. Given that there is no desire for the committee to reach this cliff edge, however, there is a flexibility in when we can make a decision on this instrument. So I'd be minded to defer a formal consideration of the motion to approve the instrument until a committee meeting in the future. Would members be happy to do that?
Yes.
It would also give the Minister time to consider whether it would be wise to reconsider the instrument and actually withdraw it for consideration again in the future. So on that basis, I think we've got agreement for the committee to defer the formal consideration of the motion today to a committee meeting in the future. Agreed?
Yes.
Okay. Excuse me. We're just going to pause once again to briefly allow for a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. I will now move on to agenda item 6, which is consideration of a negative instrument, the charges for Residue Surveillance Amendment Scotland Regulation 2024, that's SSI 2024/218. Last week's meeting, the committee agreed to defer consideration of this instrument in order to take evidence from the Minister for Agriculture and Connectivity before we disposed it. And I welcome back to the meeting Jim Fairley, the Minister for Agriculture and Connectivity, who is joined by Scottish Government officials. We have Jesus Galeo, the Senior Policy Advisor from Animal Health and Welfare Division, and Keith White, our solicitor. So before we begin, can I ask the Minister to make some introductory remarks?
Thank you again, Convener, and thanks to the Committee for giving the opportunity to give clarification on the intended consequences of this instrument, taking into account the comments made by the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee and this Committee at your meeting last week. The primary aim of this instrument is to ensure full cost recovery for services relating to the surveillance and inspection of animals and animal products for residues of veterinary medicinal products relating to the National Residues Control Programme, or the NRCP, which is managed by the Veterinary Medicines Directorate, or the VMD, across Great Britain. In terms of the anticipated costs, the policy note accompanying the regulations stated that the annual cost of delivering the NRCP currently costs approximately £5 million per annum, and this is forecast to reach approximately £8 million per annum by 2028. This is due to a rise in the costs of procured services, which are necessary to deliver the programme, such as sampling, testing and consumables. Without the proposed revisions, the current charges that the NRCP participants pay, it is forecast there will be an under-recovery of the costs of the programme by £1.2 million in the current financial year. And the deficit is, excuse me, and the deficit is expect, excuse me, my apologies, and the deficit is expected to rise to £3 million per annum by 2029. It should be stressed that the increase in cost is the estimated cost across Great Britain, so Scotland will contribute less to the overall increase, given that there is a smaller concentration of participants here. There are currently more than 500 companies across the various sectors included in the NRCP. I also want to pick up another point in which Rhoda Grant made about whether an impact island assessment was considered. As this is not a new policy, strategy or service that is likely to have an impact on an island community, which is significantly different from the effect on other communities, it was considered that, on balance, there is no assessment required in this instance. By way of conclusion, I should reiterate that the NRCP is a statutory programme and is designed to help protect human health by identifying unsafe residues of banned substances, veterinary medicines and contaminants in products of animal origin before it enters the food chain. The NRCP helps to protect human health. It also provides assurances to the UK's trading partners about the quality and safety of exported food products of animal origin. The programme helps to support international trade worth approximately £12 billion to the UK economy per annum. And I'm happy to take any questions with my officials.
Thank you, Minister. Any members' questions? Rhoda Grant.
Yes, my concern about having an island impact assessment was that I do believe it could have an impact. The Minister will be well aware that people have been talking a long time about micro-abattoirs, and the benefit, not only animal welfare, but economic benefit there would be if island communities and indeed kind of smaller communities away from markets were able to have abattoirs to, therefore they would be able to sell their own meat locally. The tourism industry would benefit because there would be local produce available. People could sell online. It would make a huge economic boost. Anything that adds to the cost, but also the bureaucracy surrounding that process, just pushes up further and further away. And that, my concern was that this regulation may do that. It might just add another hurdle to get over, making it, and I'm not suggesting for one moment we're making great progress in having abattoirs, and in fact those that are there, some of them are already under threat, but this could, one, dispense with those that are there, but also stop us getting others.
I absolutely concur with what you say about having abattoirs in particularly the island areas. I completely concur, and if we could do more to do to help that, then I would absolutely get on board with it. But this SSI is about protecting human health and making sure that there's nothing has been added. This is something that they would already have to comply with. So bureaucracy-wise, it's not going to make any difference. I get that there is a cost increase, and percentage-wise, it looks like a lot. But in terms of what it's actually going to cost a small abattoir, I don't think there's going to be enough in that, given the fact that it's on a cost per animal basis, that would put them over the edge, as it were. So there wasn't a need for a separate island impact assessment on that basis.
I guess what I'm trying to say is they're clinging on to the edge by their fingertips at the moment, those that are there, and the struggle to get others there, which is what we really want to do, that it pushes the direction of travel in the wrong direction. Yeah. And is there anything, I suppose what I'm asking really, is there anything you can do, especially for island communities, but also communities that are a long way from the centre? You know, we've been talking about Skye Abattoir and things like that for a long time. Is there anything you can do that would mitigate the challenges posed by this, and indeed some of the other challenges, if we're being realistic, to make that a reality?
I think the fundamental thing we have to remember is this is a statutory thing that we need to do in order to protect human health, and the testing system is about making sure that there are no residues go into the human food chain. And I completely take on board all the points you're making about how difficult this is. And I've already agreed to meet with other members to talk about how we can do more to help the more remote, I don't want to stop using that word, island communities as far as slaughter and provisioning is concerned. But for this, I don't think that that's going to be the clincher, and we have to do it in order to continue to make sure we're protecting human health as much as anything else.
Okay, and just could I be included in those discussions? Because I obviously represent an area where this is really crucial.
Yeah, absolutely.
It sounds a bit similar to what the last session. So can I ask the Minister, did you do any assessment of what the impact would be on smaller abattoirs or processors?
Individually, no, we didn't. What we looked at was what we needed to do in order to achieve cost recovery, full cost recovery, on the the programme of surveillance of veterinary residues?
Do you know how much, what percentage an average test for a cattle will go up by?
Percentage-wise, I think it's about 64%.
So surely that could be a significant, have a significant impact in some of these smaller abattoirs. And you know, it's when this instrument, whilst everybody agrees we need to have these inspections, and that's not changing, it's a significant rise in costs, which could have an impact on smaller processes. In fact, and I know I've been in contact with one plant who suggested their costs will increase by almost £20,000. That's not inconsiderable, and actually could put them over the edge. Certainly. Oh. Certainly. Again, guess what? The point is, we are making a decision today, and we just wanted to be sure that the government have considered the potential adverse impacts on small abattoirs. We know there's a critical mass situation in Scotland where we already have our abattoirs, our auction marts, whatever, worried about this edge, the cliff edge, the number of cattle are going through. So it's just what considerations were taken by the government?
Let Hazel answer what the considerations were done on the ground, as it were.
Thank you, Minister. The consultation document has a worked example for a typical slaughterhouse. However, that is for a large slaughterhouse, and it estimated around 100,000 cattle per year, which is a typical large slaughterhouse. However, because the charge is on a per headage, it can be applied equally to any size of slaughterhouse. So if we were looking at a typical micro abattoir in an island slaughtering, say, two cattle heads per week, 100 a year, the increase of 20p per year would represent £20 per year in total. So we're talking very small amounts, because the throughput is very small. They are very large amounts for the large slaughterhouses because their throughput is very high. So we didn't look specifically at islands versus mainland. However, we know that most of the micro abattoirs in Scotland happen to be in the island. So you can estimate the cost based on the size of the abattoir, not necessarily on the location of the abattoir. Generally speaking, even though the percentage increase is very high from 50 to 70p per cattle head, the actual increase per abattoir per year for a very small abattoir is very, very small.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Convener. I would say that the same applies to obviously the consideration for as well as abattoirs for game processing plants, milk production, fisheries, aquaculture products. Obviously Salmon Scotland did respond to the consultation. I mean, I think my point is on this SSI is that it's disappointing that most of the response came from GB-wide stakeholders, and only one came from Scotland, so from Salmon Scotland. So I think it just speaks of some of the concerns of the committee in the past of the engagement process, ensuring that people are not taken unawares of the potential that they will have to, you know, have increased costs, as particularly my colleague Rhoda Grant has discussed there. It is a difficult trading environment, and costs, inflationary pressures have seen costs rise. So I would really just ask, you know, what efforts are being made to ensure in this scenario that there's no cliff edges? Minister.
Again, I'll go back to the point that Hazel made. It's done on the headage that's going through the abattoir, so whatever the rate is, it's going to be consistent with what the throughput of that particular slaughterhouse is.
What about a small dairy?
It's a statutory thing that we have to do in order to protect human health.
Yeah.
To do that, and it's across the whole of the UK. So yeah. the £3 million excess that we're looking at is across the entire food sector across the whole of the UK. So it should have minimal impact, and we had very little in the way of responses. So people are not, they haven't responded to say that there is a real problem with this to the government.
But just to be clear, that on the options, the most people wanted the one that was sort of sector-based tailoring. So is the government... I mean, you're talking there about headage of cattle, but how is it equated? Is it litres of milk or, you know, how, for example, a game processing plant? Is it brace of pheasants or... How does this work?
I can take that, Minister. Thank you. For cattle, sheep and pigs, it's per headage. For most of the other commodities, is per weight. So it tends to be per tonne or per 100 tonnes, etc.
Right. OK. And so just to be clear again, can you tell me how that is equated? How does that work out? And so if there's a... how do we know? How do these sectors know how much they're going to be charged? If, for example, you've got a game processing facility that is very small and it only its output is only a ton.
So, in the case of game, it's per ton, £1.04 per ton. But actually, interestingly, because of this sector-by-sector estimation of the cost, wild game is the only sector where the charges don't go up at all. All the other ones do go up. And that is based on... The national programme is based on collecting approximately 30,000 samples in total across the whole of GB and all sectors, but that is split... between commodities, etc., based on risk. Some are more efficient than others to collect, mm-hmm. And so the way that the costs have been apportioned by the Veterinary Medicines Directorate is based on the actual cost of each one of those. For example, establishments that have a permanent presence, like abattoirs, it's much easier to collect a sample that from a place where somebody would have to go specifically to collect a sample. And that's what the consultation showed, is that the industry supported each sector to be considered on its merits rather than across the board, which resulted in some sectors like wild game not having an increase at all.
Yeah, and just, I'm very interested in this. I mean, I don't think that there's going to be a motion to annul or anything like that in this circumstance. We're just interested in scrutinising it. What are the costs? I notice that you've got them handy there. What are the costs for milk production?
So the current cost for milk is 0.0276 pounds, sorry, per 1,000 litres. Will go up this year to 0.373 pounds per 1,000 litres.
Okay.
And then from 2025 to 0.0405 pounds per 1,000 litres.
Hmm. Okay. Well, the only thing that I would have said is that at the end it says that the BREA says that there's no significant financial effects on business, and I just think that if we had a dairy man or dairy business in here or a game processing plant owner, I think they would probably say differently. So I just want to put that on record.
Thank you. Any other members? I've got a couple of questions. Who evaluates the delivery of this service in Scotland? And what does that evaluation look at? And did it do any additional work prior to the consideration of increasing the cost to look at whether the service is being delivered efficiently, whether there was any mitigation measures that could have been considered and adopted before putting up the cost to industry.
Yes, we do evaluate the programme. The Veterinary Medicines Directorate produces an annual report on the conclusions of the programme, which is something that we have to do. We have to present it, for example, to the European Union to maintain our export approval. We are also involved as customers at the time when the contract for particularly the laboratory services is procured, which is outsourced. A large proportion of the cost, though, comes from the sampling, which is mostly completed by competent authorities. In our case, it tends to be either our own staff or staff that we employ, like or that we contract, like the Animal and Plant Health Agency. So a large proportion of this cost is staff cost and staff time. And that's why it's going up due to inflation.
Okay, so there's no implication with regards to lack of vets or anything like that. It's simply down to staffing costs and lab costs.
It's generally staffing costs, outsourcing lab costs and consumable costs for sampling, etc.
Okay, and the last question for me is there still a requirement to test for residues that have always been the case to test for them? Is there a review of what residues that we need to test? Because it may be that there's some antibiotics or some chemicals or pesticides or whatever that may have been an issue in the past. I'm thinking of DDT or something like that where they would be testing. Is there any scope for reviewing what residues need to be tested for public safety, which would result in a reduction in the cost?
Yes, the National Control Plan is reviewed annually, and it's a risk-based control plan, so it's based on particularly findings from previous years. Some aspects just cannot be changed because they are international obligations, etc., but okay. There is scope for that.
Thank you. That's most helpful. Okay, the committee will now move on to formal consideration of the instrument. Does any member wish to make comment on the instrument? No? Everyone's content. So thank you, Minister, and your officials for attending this morning, or this afternoon. That concludes our business in public today, and we'll now move into private session. And I suspend the meeting for 2 minutes.